GST refresher course, and on day two we have with us CA Jatin Christopher to talk to us on the topic search and seizure under GST. It's a pleasure to introduce CA Jatin Christopher. He's also a cost accountant and a law graduate. After qualifying in 1996, he's been specializing in indirect tax laws. He's an invitee to the Indirect Tax Committee of the ICA New Delhi. CA Jatin is a resource person for the Institute in its various post-qualification programs on indirect taxation and extends support to ICAI in publication of educational and research material by ICAI on various indirect tax topics. He is also a resource person for the government in conducting training for practitioners, trade and officers. CA Jatin has been in practice since 2000 and specializes in advisory and litigation matters in indirect tax litigations. He's a partner in JCSS, a full service firm with presence across India. Jatin sir, may I request you to kindly talk to us on search and seizure under GST. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for this opportunity to address members of Ernakulam branch. This topic of search and seizure is right from the days, from our student days, was considered something that you don't come across very often. In practice, generally you don't come across search seizure proceedings very often. Therefore, this was primarily a topic we studied for exams. And in our practice years also, in interaction with various members, understood that this was how most members viewed search and seizure proceedings. There is a very urgent need, I feel, to bring this topic for members' consideration. When chairman spoke to me about being available to take this topic, he even expressed my eagerness to bring certain key matters to members' attention. He even accommodated a change in the schedule to be able to make it today. I know yesterday members have had a discussion on show cause notice, and I think tomorrow there is a session on prosecution, is that right? What we have to bear in mind,
finalization of accounts in GST.
Finalization, you're right. So to some it may sound that maybe search proceedings should be discussed after those topics, but due to the my request, and which was accommodated, for which I'm very grateful, this topic contains certain very tremendously important matters. You know, my sense of urgency around this is so elevated that I have even been talking to departmental officers to organize a training for their own officers, because they are issuing incorrect notices. I'll begin by presenting to you one very wonderful words of the Privy Council in Nazir Ahmad versus King Emperor, year 1936, PC 253, where the Privy Council said, when power is given to do a particular thing, that thing must be done in that manner or not at all. If you do it, you do it this way only. You cannot do whatever way you like to do simply because it involves revenue. Passion to protect revenue does not permit bypassing the law. That is the principle all members need to very fiercely hold on to, because today the tax department is the one who is least understanding these provisions of law. I have even taken some time to touch upon some provisions relating to search and seizure in income tax, customs, central excise, sales tax law also, to see where this language that we have in GST is originating from. Friends, please bear in mind, audit is different from inspection. Audit is under section 65. Inspection is under section 67. We have limited time. Members are welcome to send in your questions, but I'm expecting that there may not be many questions, although Deepa ma'am said questions will be posted by members on the chat box or the Q&A tab, but I am This topic of section 67 has, I have been spending several months studying chapter 67, section 67 only. Section 67 has taken away several months of my time, and I want to bring certain important aspects for your consideration. GST is a self-assessment tax, which means there is no assessing officer in GST. Please bring that into your understanding very firmly. There is nobody called an assessing officer in GST. Any officer thinks he is an assessing officer, you please educate him that he is an audit officer, he is an inspecting authority, he is an appellate authority, but he is not an assessing officer. So who is the assessing officer? The taxpayer himself is the assessing officer, because when the tax is a self-assessment tax, the person doing the assessment is the assessing authority. Taxpayer will decide whether it is a supply or whether it is not a supply. If it is a supply, whether it is goods or services. If it is one of the two, what is the classification? Whether any exemption is applicable? What is the valuation? Whether any adjustments to the valuation are required? And so on and so forth. And he determines his liability. Once a liability is determined, that liability has to be disclosed and discharged. Where do we disclose the liability? Disclosure of the liability is in GSTR 1 under section 37. So please note that GSTR 1 is not the place where liability is getting assessed. Liability is getting assessed in section 31. Once the liability is self-assessed, it is merely being disclosed in returns filed under section 37, and the liability disclosed in 37 is discharged under 39. If you look at Priya Blue's decision of Supreme Court, for later affirmed in ITC Limited, Supreme Court very clearly said the document on which the assessment is made is the assessment order. There is no need for yet another order. So therefore, friends, if the tax department were to ever in GST attempt to say two things. One, please bring your books of accounts. I want to verify. Please bring your books of accounts, invoices, bills, vouchers, ITC register, etc., etc. I want to verify your assessment. Please reply to the officer with great politeness, asking him. Always on three points we have to reply to departmental communication. Point number one, acknowledge the communication. They sent the letter by email, by Gmail, by Yahoo Mail, by SMS, by WhatsApp, by portal, by registered post. Whichever way they send it, please acknowledge it. Point number one, we received your communication dated so-and-so on so-and-so date. Point number two, we reject the proceedings being initiated by you and the demand contained therein. Please reject. Why you should reject? Please tell me. Please note, there is section 7512. What does section 7512 say? Whenever there is a self-assessed liability that is not discharged, and interest on such a self-assessed liability, there is no requirement to give show cause notice. Direct recovery action can be taken under section 79. So therefore, friends, please bear in mind, you need to shift any demand raised by the department from an undisputed arrear to a disputed arrear category. Once it is disputed, due process of law should take over, and there is no requirement for notice will arise. Now, there are three decisions I can think of. Reflex Industries, Madras High Court. Mahadeva Constructions, Jharkhand High Court. And LC Infra Projects, Karnataka High Court, which says there is a requirement to issue notice. Without notice, how can you take recovery action? I feel this point that GST is a self-assessment-based tax was not brought to the attention of the court. Anyway, if you see in Finance Act 2021, an explanation is inserted under section 7512 to say, when a liability is admitted in the returns under section 37, but it is not discharged in the returns under section 39, there is no requirement for issuing a show cause notice. So friends, please bear in mind, here is a government that is not only keen on implementing recovery action of self-assessed liability, but it is also determined to amend the law if required to give more teeth to their intentions. So therefore, the second point in our replies should be, I reject the proceedings being, I dispute the proceedings being made and I reject the demand made therein. Point number three in our reply, I rely on section 160 subsection 2. Friends, you might like to make note of section 160 subsection 2. When you look at section 160 subsection 2, it says in the opposite. What does it say? It says, if any person entertains a notice, order, or warrant or proceeding that is not validly served, if a person entertains it, or if a person fails to question such a proceeding, then the person shall forego his right to question in later proceedings. In other words, it talks about the principle of acquiescence. What is acquiescence? By entertaining an improper notice, it becomes proper. By not questioning an improper notice, it becomes a proper notice. So therefore, friends, three-step reply to all communication. We received it, we reject it, and we rely on 160 subsection 2 and ask you, please tell me under which section you are taking this action. In GST, friends, there is no section under which department can say, bring the books of accounts to my office, I want to check your liability. That is not at all possible. The only instance where it is possible to a limited extent is section 65, where department has to come to our premises to do this audit. We'll come to section 65 in a little bit, but let's look at what are the powers that they don't have. Because in the past, we are so used to taking books to the department that even now I am seeing there's an instance of someone in Ludhiana who was asked to take the books of accounts to the department. He took it to the department. They arrived at some liability. Somebody in Kannur was called to bring some files to the office. They carried it and they end up with a show cause notice. So please bear in mind, always ask which section. Once you know which section, then you will know who is the proper officer who has the power under that section. Once you know who is the proper officer under that section, you will know what is the limits to his power under that section. Therefore, what is the consequences? The second thing that is not there in GST is no spot recovery. Officer visited, he came to a conclusion that you are not paying your tax properly. He explained to your liability, explained your liability to you, and you went and discharged that liability. In GST, there is no such thing called spot recovery. That is why there is an exorbitant interest rate. The taxpayer enjoys the freedom of self-assessment at the perils of interest and penalty. You want the freedom to be your own assessing authority? Okay. But be careful, if you make any mistake, you're liable for interest on tax at 18%, interest on credit at 24%, and penalty. So therefore, once I have accepted the risk and the responsibility, how can any departmental officer say he is going to verify? It has to be under a particular section. So the second question members are going to always bear in mind is, ask which section. There is a notice issued under section 35 stating that you are not maintaining your books of accounts properly. We propose to impose penalty under section 125. Reply to the notice saying under which section you are asking to impose penalty, because section 35 tells me how I should maintain books of accounts and records. Section 35 does not give you the power to give show cause notice. The officer obviously got upset, and members may be very concerned, are how I can upset an officer tomorrow, he will take revenge. That is the fear, isn't it? Fear is existing where knowledge is not existing. I strongly submit to members, please give up your fears, because in GST, there are exceptional taxpayer safeguards. There are a lot of safeguards for taxpayer, and the greatest safeguard for taxpayer is that everything has to be in writing. Nothing can be verbal. So therefore, we said you cannot give me show cause notice under section 35. Officer said, I want to speak to you. So we spoke to the officer and told him, so section 35 tells me how I need to maintain accounts and records. Section 35 does not permit you to issue show cause notice. Officer said, then under which section can I give show cause notice? To understand which section you should give show cause notice, you should join GST refresher course conducted by ICAI. You cannot ask me. I am here only to argue the case. 1.5 years over, officer has not come back. Another aspect that the department cannot do, the third thing, Third thing, first is department cannot call for books of accounts. Second thing, there is no spot recovery. Third thing in GST is department cannot visit your premises. There was a recent seminar for training seminar for tax officers, departmental officers. So he said there is no power for departmental officers to visit taxpayer premises. Officers were very disturbed. How can you say I don't have the power to visit taxpayer premises? Yes, you don't have the power to visit taxpayer premises. After lunch break, one officer came and said, sir, there is section 71. 71 is giving me access to business premises, so I can come to your business premises. The answer to that question lies in the fact that section 71 does not have a corresponding rule. There is no rule in the rules corresponding to section 71. Therefore, section 71 itself is the machinery section. If 71 is the machinery section, there is no provision for 71 itself to be activated. 71 is a machinery for 22 registration, for 65 audit, for 67 inspection, for 69 arrest, those provisions. Somebody is raising their hands in this chat box. I can see. I have no idea what to do if you raise your hand. Please excuse me for this lack of awareness of all this technology. You can send your questions on the chat box or the Q&A box. I will try to answer those questions later. But there are some urgent issues to be brought to your attention. So kindly lend me your ears so that you're able to attend, appreciate some of the points that I want to share with you. So therefore, please bear in mind, don't entertain improper notices. If you entertain improper notices, you are foregoing your rights to question the validity of any notice. I'll give a small analogy. There's a patient who was taken to the operating theater stating that he had a problem in the stomach. Some surgery was required to be performed. When he was taken out of the operating theater, not only was there stitches on his stomach, but there are stitches in his chest also. So the people asked the doctor, what is this? Why stitches in the chest? Stomach, there are stitches because some operation you did. Why stitches in the chest? No, I was doing stomach surgery. Suddenly I came to know there is some problem in the heart. Anyway, we have admitted patient. Anyway, operation is started. I thought side by side, I will do heart operation also. I finished everything. Lump sum I have done with a discount also. We can do this surgery. Please bear in mind, as ridiculous as something like this sounds, so ridiculous is the proceeding under an improper section in GST. Today is not the time for us to go into 61 to 64. We'll straight away go into section 65 briefly in order to appreciate what is there in section 67. 65 talks about the commissioner or any officer authorized by the commissioner may by a general or special order direct that an audit to be conducted. What is audit 213? Defines audit to be basically verification of correctness of. Verification of correctness of what? Of everything. Turnover, input credit, refund, returns, everything is verification. There is no need to elaborate to auditors what is audit, because there is no, it's a very wide language. The boundaries are very wide in section 65. Now come to section 67. 67 says, where a proper officer not below the rank of joint commissioner has reasons to believe that. What is it? Where a proper officer not below the rank of joint commissioner has reason to believe that. That means nobody less than a JC should have reasons to believe. What is reasons to believe? See, there are three levels of suspicion. There is suspicion. Mostly I have doubt in this color, not being tapped correctly. Suspicion. Above suspicion is reason to believe. That means I have some intelligence. I have some reliable intelligence. That is reason to believe. Next level, evidence in possession. I have some evidence in my possession. I have an invoice where the GST shown is wrong. So therefore, section 67.1 covers only those cases where there is a reason to believe, and reason to believe is not by anybody but an officer of the rank of joint commissioner. See, there is a very nice decision. Whenever we think of a discretion, Mata Job Dobe versus H.C. Bihari, is a very old decision of 1955, where it says discretionary power is not necessarily discriminatory power. You cannot assume that there is an abuse of power because the discretion is given to a high ranking official and not a minor official. Matajog Dube versus H.C. Bihari. Therefore, friends, when a joint commissioner and not some LGSTO who will come to this opinion, that there is reason to believe. What is the reason to believe? Three things. 67.1A, 67.1B, two things are there. 67.1A deals with a taxable person. 67.1B deals with any person. So the reason to believe can be about taxable person or it can be about any person. Let's analyze 67.1 carefully to understand what can be done and therefore what all cannot be done. There are three important words I want to highlight in 67.1A. Has suppressed, has availed, has evaded. Isn't it? Three words you have to understand. Has suppressed, has claimed, has indulged. Has suppressed, has claimed, has indulged. Three things. Has suppressed, has claimed, has indulged. Who has done all this? Only taxable person. Who is taxable person? Person defined in 2108. If you look at 9-1 forward charge, 9-1 forward charge, and such tax shall be paid by the taxable person. Taxable person is a person who is registered under 22 or liable to register under 22 or 24. So therefore, friends, if you are the recipient, if you are the transporter, if you are the agent, if you are the warehouse keeper, if you are the chartered accountant, you cannot be inspected under 67.1A. You have to be the taxable person only. 67B talks about any person. Who is any person? Can it be chartered accountant? Absolutely not. Any person who has kept accounts of goods where evasion has taken place, or the goods are kept. See, person who is keeping the books or the warehouse where the goods involved in evasion are stored. So therefore, please bear in mind, chartered accountants should refrain from having registered office of companies in their address. Chartered accountants office should not be the registered address of the client, because your office therefore becomes the place where books are kept involving an evasion, and it can be inspected under 67.1B. So please keep this aspect. As long as the board resolution passed by the company says that the accounts are maintained at the registered office of the company, which may be the director's residence also, the books may be brought to the chartered accountant's office for audit purpose, but inspection cannot be conducted at the auditor's office. 67.1A has suppressed. Suppressed what? Suppressed supply or stock. Suppressed the supply or suppress the stock. Has claimed what? Input tax credit greater than his entitlement. I give a small illustration. Suppose I have taken credit in respect of my reversal under rule 42 is not correct. There is a calculation I have made, and the calculation says I have to reverse 5 lakhs, but according to department, the calculation is that I have to reverse 10 lakhs. Can the department say under 67.1A, you have claimed credit greater than your entitlement? Absolutely, 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 absolutely not. Because anything that is to be determined after verification cannot be pre-existing reasons to believe. Very important language to note here. Has suppressed. Suppose I have taken credit on bogus invoices, then it is possible I have claimed credit in excess of my entitlement. If I am regularly running my business, within the business, what is eligible, what is not eligible, which is motor vehicle, which is rental cab, cannot be inspected under section 67. Please keep in mind, the third aspect is has indulged. Indulged in what? Indulged in anything, contravention of the act or the rules there under, with the intention to evade payment of tax. Merely making a mistake in the compliance does not amount to contravention to evade tax. The result of the mistake can be non-payment of tax. Every non-payment does not become evasion. Every non-payment cannot become evasion. When will non-payment become evasion? Non-payment will become evasion if there is knowledge of liability. See, there is no punishment in law for stupidity. For stupidity, there is no punishment as long as I believe what I am saying is correct. Very intelligently or very stupidly, as long as what I am saying I believe is correct, there is no question that my interpretation can be tantamount to evasion. Please keep that aspect in mind. Later, whether it tantamounts to suppression or not is a different aspect under 74, but ex facie it cannot be treated as evasion. So there are three reasons to believe. See, it is not reasons only. Three reasons to believe. I'll come to this very important aspect. What should be the three reason? I have suppressed my supply or stock. How anybody will know once it is a self-assessment tax? How department will come to know that I have suppressed my supply? They will not know. They cannot come here and then discover. Even if I have done some suppression of supply, department cannot come to a assumption that there is a suppression without visiting my premises. So there cannot be jurisdiction secure after inspection. Please keep in mind three reasons. What is it? Has suppressed, has claimed, and has contravened, isn't it? Has indulged in contravention. So if these three terms are the reasons, please see the next two words, to believe. To believe. To believe something does not mean to assume something. Reason to assume, no. Reason to believe. A very beautiful decision in Barium Chemicals versus A.J. Rana. Barium Chemicals, very beautiful decision where the Supreme Court has explained the concept of how do you come to this belief? It cannot be a whim, reasonlessness. There cannot be a reason for you to believe. If I look at this fellow, I think he is a crooked fellow. That is not the reason. That is the assumption. See, if you look at section 65, how will department do audit? They will take up audit based on risk. Like all chartered accountants, when we take up internal audit, we'll select areas based on a risk perception. How is risk perceived in audit under 65? Three types of reasons I have been able to identify. One, reason can be for the industry itself, real estate development, always some hanky-panky is going on, so better to do audit of real estate sector. Job working involving jewelry, always some mess is there, so I think they are risky. So certain industry risks are there. Next, certain product risk, that is the goods or the service, the commodity itself may be risky. For example, job working, for example, exports, for example, deemed exports, for example, EOU. Generally, in those cases, the commodity itself will throw some risks. The third, entity risk. ABC Private Limited is a crooked fellow, everybody knows. XYZ Private Limited is a crooked fellow. We got information from department, income tax department. So therefore, what you can, when you go to do stomach surgery, you cannot do heart surgery. Please remember, when you go to do audit under section 65, you don't need any reason to believe. You feel there is some reason to audit, you start audit. You come out with a finding, you don't come out with a finding, that is the result of your exercise. But for 67, you must have a reason, and that reason must be backed up with a belief. How will this belief come? There has to be intelligence, consideration of that intelligence, or material available on record. Some complaint, some information, some documentation. Now the question that arises is, how to ask the officer whether he has reason to believe? You cannot ask the officer whether he has reason to believe. Please refer Radhakishan Industries versus State of Himachal Pradesh, Appeal number 1155 of 2021. Nothing new in this decision. All the old principles have been reiterated in this decision. In this decision, if you see what it says, referring to all the old decisions, classic is Barium Chemicals. Barium Chemicals, very clearly it says, the court will only examine if there are reasons to believe. The court will not substitute joint commissioner's reasons for the court's reasons. Court will only examine whether there are reasons. What are the reasons? Not important. Whether there are reasons or not will be examined by the court. Now, the reason is not empty reason. Reason to believe. to believe something, there has to be some basis, some material, some information, some intelligence. It cannot be suspicion. Suspicion, reason to believe, evidence on record. Three levels are there. It is not sufficient to have suspicion. Suspicion is sufficient to do audit, but suspicion is insufficient to do inspection under 67. So therefore, friends, there have to be only these three reasons. Now I'll give you a small example. Can department come and do inspection saying 2A credit is greater than is less than 3B? Can department issue a notice saying that we want to do inspection because 2A is less than 3B, therefore you have taken into input credit greater than what you're entitled to? Absolutely, absolutely not. Because evade tax, the words to evade tax is inbuilt in all the three reasons. Suppressing the supply, suppressing the stock obviously has an intention to evade payment of tax. Has availed input credit greater than his entitlement, has an intention to evade payment of tax. Has indulged in any contravention, obviously has an intention to evade payment of tax. Inaccuracy, bona fide tax position, clerical errors are not sufficient reasons to believe. So please keep this aspect in mind. Recently, we have received number of notices under 67 stating that your 9C is giving some reconciliation different from what you have shown in 3B. Therefore, in the intention to evade payment of tax, we want to issue notice. So we reply to the notice saying three things. What are we saying to every notice? We received your letter dated so and so on so and so date. We dispute the proceedings. We reject the demand being raised therein. And we rely on section 160 subsection 2, where we are barred from entertaining such improper notices. So therefore, the respondent officer is now consulting with additional commissioner what he needs to do next. Please keep in mind, don't entertain improper proceedings. What will happen if you entertain improper proceedings? You will forego your right to question the improper proceedings later. So please be very careful. Tax officers are also depending on taxpayer's ignorance. Taxpayer is depending on taxpayer not knowing GST. But please keep in mind, many tax officers are waiting for a taxpayer to give a reply. Yes, sir, I received a letter that 2A has a reconciliation difference because B2C, B2B, like time limit for GST or one amendment is over, B2C, GST number is wrong. We start giving some reasons. That means we are given up the right to question the notice. Please be very, very mindful of this. Three reasons, and it has to be to believe. Now, when you look at reasons to believe, what happened in the allocation industry? Supreme Court said, I don't agree with this, but Supreme Court said, there are some reasons, but not good enough to reach a belief. Like that, they may not. So therefore, please keep in mind, an officer is not going to take the risk. Officer is not going to take the risk. If ultimately demand won't sustain, what is the purpose of wasting time raising all these issues? So therefore, please keep in mind, time limit is running out. Now, time limit for any demand, as you know, under 7410 is 5 years from the annual return due date. Annual return due date also for 1718 was 7th February 2020. So the due date for any demand is 6th February 2025. Please keep these due dates in mind. If a department takes 2A versus 3B as an issue and gives a notice under 67, now this is a very important aspect. Members have to be very attentive to this aspect. If department gives a show cause notice by proceeding under 67, stating 2A is less than 3B, as a taxpayer, I will reply as follows. I will reply only on technical objection that there is no jurisdiction. I will not reply why 2A and 3B are not matching. Because why 2A and 3B are not matching, there are 1,000 reasons. First, you tell me who are you. If you tell me who you are, whether you have the right jurisdiction, then I will give all answers. Now, officer is not happy. He will pass ex parte order. I will go on appeal. In appeal, I will ask the question, please tell me whether this person had the authority to ask me this question. If he did not have the question authority, then the question cannot be asked. Legitimate discovery through illegitimate proceedings are vitiated. Legitimate proceedings, legitimate discovery through illegitimate proceedings are Vitiated. So therefore, I will ask the first appellate authority that such a rubbish notice cannot be given. He has no jurisdiction. First appellate authority says, correct, he has no jurisdiction. Now already it is 5th February 2025. Can the department now give me another show cause notice? Impossible. On the other hand, if I say he has no jurisdiction, without prejudice to the above ground, I am giving you reasons for 2A versus 3B. What happens? Officer will say, I have jurisdiction. Why will he say I have jurisdiction? Because he is the creature of the statute. He will not sit in judgment on his own jurisdiction. So he will say, okay, I have jurisdiction. Since I have jurisdiction and you have given me reply on merits, I will pass a ruling on merits. Once a ruling on merits is passed, 90% your case is finished. Why? Because you have given up your legal remedies. Now members will want to take a reference to rule 112. What does rule 112 say? Rule 112 says any grounds not taken in earlier proceedings cannot be taken up unless sufficient cause is shown. Which means if I don't reply on merits, can they say tomorrow they will not allow me to raise merits in further proceedings? Please consider, when jurisdiction is questioned, jurisdiction is so fundamental. It is like saying in stomach surgery, doctor not able to find the heart. Since he has entered the stomach, he cannot find the heart. It is not there. It is not his business to look into anything outside the area where he has the jurisdiction. So therefore, I feel rule 112 cannot do any more damage. Maximum what will happen? Under 1131, tribunal will hear the matter, rule in the matter of jurisdiction and remand it for redetermination on merits. So please, 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 please be very careful. Don't forfeit your rights with your enthusiasm to give reply on merits. Next, reasons to believe have to be existing and the reasons to believe are not open for question. Now what will happen? 67.1, either the three reasons are there for taxable person or the two reasons are there for any person, and 67.1 says such a proper officer who has reason to believe, he may grant authorization to conduct an inspection. Friends, please keep in mind, inspection is totally different from search. Inspection is totally different from search. It is only to come and inspect. Where 71, access the prison, you will come, you will check, you will look for certain things, and you will satisfy yourself. Please keep in mind, authorization is very important. Now, the format of the authorization prescribed is INS-1. INS-1 is the authorization format. In INS-1, authorization is given. What should be stated in the authorization? Three things have to be stated. Out of 67-1A or B, whether taxable person has to be inspected or any person has to be inspected, that must be, there must be precise person. Next, there must be precise location. All your places we will inspect, that is not possible. Particular address, you have to tell me where you want to inspect. I may have 10 shops, I may have 15 other warehouses. You decide where you want to inspect. If you come with the INS-1 with at the wrong address, I will send you back, you have to go again. Now, how you can say such things, sir? CBIC has issued instruction number 1 of 2021, dated 2nd February 2021, giving very clear steps how taxpayer rights are going to be safeguarded. If you look at the instructions, you will be surprised. It looks like a movie. The INS-1 will be granted and the INS-1 will be shown to the person and a signature taken that he has seen it. Second, the officer should be searched. The instruction says, first you search the officers, then you allow them to check the premises. That is what instruction itself is saying. So therefore, friends, whether we will actually search any officer or not, I don't know, but definitely we have a statutory basis and instructions on the board itself as to how inspection need to be carried out. So therefore, three things: person, address, and most important, reason to believe. The reason to believe must be specified very clearly in INS-1 itself. Now, There are a number of decisions to say the reason to believe not stated in the INS 1 is not fatal to the proceeding, not in the context of GST, in income tax and customs, etc. But please keep in mind the procedure in the department is an officer will collect some intelligence. He will prepare a file note and put it up to the joint commissioner or additional commissioner and say, sir, for these reasons to believe, I feel you should give me authorization in INS 1 to conduct inspection of so-and-so person or so-and-so premises. Now the joint commissioner will apply his mind. There cannot be non-application of mind. When there is a requirement to apply mind, there cannot be subcontracting the mind also. Okay, superintendent has told, therefore I agree. That is not allowed. Joint commissioner or additional commissioner only should apply their mind. In the file, they will make a note. I will tell you how to get the file notings copy for yourself. In the file, they have to make a note while giving authorization in INS 1. It does not say that INS 1 copy has to be handed over to the person while inspecting. But you please appreciate what are all the preparatory steps required under 67.1 compared to 65.1. Will department who wants to do routine audit come in and do all this in 67.1? When 67.1 proceedings are being followed, can they do routine verification? What is audit? 2 subsection 13 defines audit as to verify correctness of turnover, credit, refund, etc., 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 etc. So when you come to 61, 67, only stomach operation can be done. No leg operation, no head operation, no hand operation, no heart operation. Why? Because there is no jurisdiction. If you want to exercise jurisdiction, you should have that in INS 1 itself. Now tell me, what is the date of INS 1? INS 1 is given before or after inspection. Of course, without INS 1, inspection cannot be conducted. Therefore, INS 1 must be dated before the date of inspection. If the reason to believe have to be contained in the INS 1, then the reasons to believe must be existing before the INS 1. So friends, sequence of events. Reason to believe, file noting of the reason to believe, convincing joint commissioner that reason exists, grant of authorization to issue INS 1, then only conduct the inspection. So please, 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 please bear in mind, please do not entertain walk-in interview by officer. Officer cannot simply walk in. I was just going by the bazaar road. I thought I'd stop and check with you what we can do. No, no walk-in. Only with prior authorization. When you look at section 67.1, please be very careful. Following things cannot be checked in inspection. What are the following things? Friends, we are still in subsection 1. We haven't even gone to subsection 2. We have subsection 12 to cover. Please appreciate 67 is a very powerful tool in the hands of the taxpayer. All the safeguards are there. Don't throw it away. Now, in following cases, cannot be checked up in a 67 proceedings. One, classification verification cannot be done. I'll give an example. Puja Samagri. Puja Samagri is exempt from GST. Puja Samagri is a Puja Samagri before Puja or after Puja? Now we will all give wrong answers, so we will not go into the what is the answer. The point is to determine classification, investigation into the facts are necessary. Is it possible for department to have all the facts sufficient to feed the reason to believe? No. Classification cannot be examined in 67. Exemption notification cannot be considered in 67. Valuation cannot be examined in 67. 2A, 3B, 17.5, 17.2, Rule 42, 43. All this cannot be checked. Routine matters. Friends, you are the best judge. You decide what is a routine matter. Routine matter 65. Routine matter 65, special matter only 67. Now we will see how you can say a routine matter cannot be checked up in 67.1. I will tell you. Then what can be checked up in 67.1? See, remember, we talk about taxable person. Other person is very simple. Taxable person has suppressed, has claimed, has indulged. Has suppressed what? There is stock, no invoice. Has suppressed. There is invoice, no stock. Supply. See, there is stock and invoice. Stock is different item, invoice is different item. See, as suppressed supply or stocks. So quantitative deviation can be questioned. Point number one. Next, has claimed credit in excess of his entitlement. What is entitlement? Two instances I will give you. Bogus invoices where there is no supply itself. You have taken credit on, somebody has taken credit on those invoices. So in excess of his entitlement. It cannot be you have not paid your creditors within 180 days. That is not entitlement. That is question of fact. Routine matters. Routine matter. 180 days you are not paid under Rule 37. So therefore you can't take the credit or reverse the credit. So those are all routine matters. Has claimed credit in excess of entitlement. Next. Suppose and then has indulged in contravention of the provision of the act or the rules made thereunder to evade payment of tax. Refund has been claimed and it has been sanctioned, refund sanction, but export invoice not properly endorsed, SEZ invoice not properly endorsed, 2A-3B matching not completed. See, again, routine matters, routine matters. In order to take proceedings under 67, special matters, not routine matters. Now, what do you consider routine? What do you consider routine? If your entire TB is in 3B, if your entire TB has been suitably disclosed in 3B, then I feel everything is routine matters. If everything is routine matters, nothing can be taken under 67. Please keep that aspect in mind. There are many taxpayers who don't want to disclose non-taxable turnover in 9 and 9C. Although table number 5 of 9 says you have to disclose exempt, zero rated, non-taxable, non-GST, no supply, everything you have to disclose. Taxpayers don't want to disclose. Agricultural income, sale of rubber in an estate owned by a chartered accountant, not disclosed in table number 5 if it is non-taxable, or table number 4 if it is taxable. See, wherever we omit disclosing, it does not remain routine matters any longer. Please disclose. The more you disclose in 9 and 9C, the less opportunity you are giving for 67. Now, you can disclose it in the wrong heading. Exempt turnover is shown as non-GST supply. Non-GST supply is shown as no supply. It doesn't matter. See, then it becomes a matter of interpretation. Matters of interpretation of the law cannot be 67. Please keep that aspect in all that. If that is the basis on which INS-1 will be granted, let us look at INS-1 itself. INS-1 contains three parts, part A, B, C. Part A, B, and C, these three parts specify taxable person A, any person B, and seizure search in C. So 67.2, we have to see what is search. Where the premises is inspected and the proper officer not below rank of joint commissioner has reason to believe. No, some more reason to believe is there. What is it? Some more reason to believe. New reasons. The reason to believe that is sufficient to authorize inspection are the same reasons sufficient to authorize a search. Sir, what is the difference between inspection and search? Inspection is come and look. Search means open and see lot of difference. In inspection, you will cooperate. Please show me your books of accounts. You will open the tally and show them everything. You will open your ERP and show them everything. Please show me this file, show me that file. Search is you please sit in one corner. I will open the cupboard and see. See, there's a lot of difference. So 67.1 is authorized in INS-1. 67.2 is authorized in part C INS-1. Now, how many times INS-1 will be given? For 67.1, once it will be given, after inspecting, suddenly they will get a new information. They will rush back to the joint commissioner, take one more signature in INS-1 part C. No. INS-1 part A, B, and C are already signed in the beginning itself, which means the reason to believe should not merely be sufficient to support inspection, it should be sufficient to support search also. Now, what can be searched? Let us see. What can be searched? If you look at 67.2, it says two things can be searched. Two things can be searched. One, goods liable to confiscation. Goods liable to confiscation can be searched and seized. Second, documents, books, or things which are considered useful in later proceedings are secreted that can be searched. Now the word secreted, does it apply only to documents, books and things, or does it apply to goods liable for confiscation also? Are secret. If you look at the 67.2, before are secreted, there is a comma. There is a comma before are secreted, which means are secreted applies to both. Goods liable to confiscation are also secreted. Documents, books or things are also secreted. What is secreted? What is secreted? Accounts filing kept in accountant's cupboard is not secreted. Accounts file kept in accountant's cupboard is not called secreted. Accounts file kept in marketing department cupboard, that is secreted. Goods kept in warehouse, not secreted. Warehouse not included as additional place of business, then secreted. Goods kept openly in the shop floor, not secreted. Goods kept in the basement with a trap door, that is secreted. So therefore, friends, if something is openly kept, there cannot be a seizure. If it is secreted only, there can be a seizure. Now you please go back to the earlier point. INS 1 part A, B and C have to be signed before the date of inspection itself. If inspection conducted on February 10th, the secreting should be known prior to 10th of February itself. It is not like they will come to do the inspection. During the inspection, they will suddenly see that in the cupboard there is a secret compartment where there are some more ledgers and diaries, so they want to do search. No, you cannot. You should know. I thought there is diamond here, but when I come there, I find that there is computers. There cannot be accidental discoveries. See, please bear in mind, GST is a self-assessment tax. Government has surrendered its power to interfere in the business. The intervention by the business, by the government is exceptional. Exceptional power is given in 67. Exceptional power has to be used in exceptional circumstances. Now, ultimately, we are going to collect revenue. Passion to collect revenue, passion to protect the interests of revenue does not permit bypassing the due process of law. So please bear in mind, no accidental discovery. Why there is no accidental discovery? I invite your attention to section 147 of Income Tax Act. What does 147 of Income Tax Act say? 146, 147 basically talks about income escaping assessment, isn't it? 147 essentially touches, if assessing officer has reason to believe that any income, I've written it down, so I'm reading it, I don't memorize it. If the assessing officer has reason to believe that any income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment for so and so, he may assess or reassess such income. And also any other income chargeable to tax which has escaped assessment. So there can be a subsequent discovery. The discovery was never there. I wanted to find gold. I found gold. I also found computers. See, there is a subsequent discovery. The law must permit such expansion of scope. The law must permit expansion of scope. If the law does not permit expansion of scope, please bear in mind, it is beyond the scope. Nazir Ahmad King Emperor, when a power to do a particular thing is given, that power must be exercised in that manner only or not at all. See, if the department changes the language of the power, see, the one who has been given the power, in exercise of the power, cannot expand the power.
What do you think, sir?
If one who has been given the power, in exercise of that power, cannot expand that power, he has to only carry out the power and not alter the power. The power is given to search two things: goods liable to confiscation or documents, books or things which are secreted. So if you look at what is secreted, it has to be established that it is secret. Now the question that arises, how to question these things? When there is an inspection, keep quiet and cooperate. When there is an inspection, keep quiet and cooperate. There is nothing a taxpayer can do, but remember, taxpayer does not have to pay any spot payment. Three things in GST is not there. You are the, there is no assessing officer, you are the assessing officer. There is no spot recovery. Third thing is that where self-assessed liability is there, notice is not required. But where there's a disputed liability, the proceeding has to take place as per 7374. So therefore, when there is an inspection, please stay quiet, allow the officer to do whatever they want. It is a duty of the taxpayer to furnish the facts. The taxpayer is not required to interpret the facts. What is furnish the fact, interpret the fact? Have you made a sale, not made a sale? Sir, here is the invoice, here is the purchase order, here is the e-way bill, I have concluded the transaction. Whether it is a sale or a lease or a rental, that is interpretation. Taxpayer is only required to furnish the facts, not interpret the facts. Whether it is goods or services, matter of interpretation. I will interpret something, department will interpret something else. In section 67, having looked at only two subsections, I'm sure members are able to appreciate that routine matters cannot be taken up under section 67. In GST, there is a anti-evasion wing in the State Department. There is a jurisdictional officer. Everybody is doing everything. Everybody is doing everything. There is a provision in the Karnataka VAT Act where very wide powers are given. The same officer or any other officer, he can come, he can inspect, he can check records, he can ask for payment, he can determine liability, he can record summons, he can arrest the person, he can seize the goods. Complete free hand is given in the earlier. But today in GST, if you see the language of 67, we can trace to 12F of Central Excise Act 1944. There is tremendous taxpayer safeguards as to what can or cannot be done. So when you look at this aspect, please bear in mind, search is conducted. The reason to believe inspection is needed is not good enough as reason to believe that search should be conducted. When a search is conducted, these two things are identified. They will search thinking that there is goods liable for confiscation, but they find that nothing is there, nothing liable for confiscation is there. They cannot search, seize it and go, because what can be seized is only what is searched. What can be seized is only what is searched. Then there are two more clause subsections which we have to touch upon, where they cannot seize it and go. They will issue an order of, okay, seizure order is passed in INS 2. I come back to INS 2, where seizure cannot be done because it is very big or very heavy or it is very far away. An order of prohibition in INS 3 will be issued, where the person will be entrusted saying, don't give this to anybody. For example, suppose a company premises is searched and the company is holding finished goods belonging to the customer. That cannot be seized. The company is holding capital goods belonging to a client for job working purpose, some capital goods, raw material given, that cannot be seized. Only the taxpayer's offending articles can be seized. In case somebody else's articles are kept, then order of prohibition can also be given. And when during search, if something is suspected to be secreted, no, then they can break open a cupboard, vault, almirah, or a electronic storage. Can be opened. They cannot, it's not like break open means everything has to be broken open. Whatever is the appropriate way of breaking open, if it is a computer or a hard disk or a server, then they can get some technical people to hack and open the computer. Or if the taxpayer cooperates, taxpayer will only give the password and it will be opened. But the power to break open is there. One very important provision to touch upon is, we'll come back to 6 and 7 regarding 67, 6 and 7. We'll go to 67.8. 67.8 touches upon one very important aspect. What is 67.8? There are certain goods which are perishable in nature. Perishable in nature. Tobacco, areca nut, some articles are there which are perishable in nature. Whenever there are perishable articles, department has the power to sell the goods, market value or the tax payable, whichever is lower, need to be paid. So they can sell it to anybody, or the taxpayer may himself come forward and pay the, which is it, market value of the perishable goods or the tax payable, whichever is lower, not higher, whichever is lower has to be paid. Friends, please bear in mind, there's a notification 27 bar 18 notification is there, which says exactly how they should go about these proceedings. Why these proceedings are so important is because it is not permitted for the department to seize perishable goods and later it discovers that there is no realizable value out of those perishable goods. Coming to perishable goods, we have to now touch upon provisional release. Section 67(6) permits provisional release of goods. What is provisional release? Certain goods are seized, goods liable to confiscation, or documents, books or things have been seized. Then taxpayer can make an application and collect the seized goods by giving a bond in INS-4. INS-4 is the provision release bond. He will give a provision release bond and collect those goods. Now, taking the, suppose finished goods have been seized, I will take provisional release, then can I sell it? No. The condition of provisional release is it will be kept with the taxpayer to be produced to the department whenever required. So what is very important from that point of view is that for the department, they have to indicate very clearly, they have to indicate very clearly whether they propose to issue any show cause notice. So friends, in 67, you will very clearly see that whatever they do ultimately has to conclude by giving a show cause notice. What have they done? Goods are liable for confiscation. We have to touch upon section 130. I'll go to 130 in a little while. Goods are liable for confiscation, they are secreted, or documents, books or things are required for further investigation. They have to do further investigation. But remember, after all the investigation, they cannot come and say your exemption is not correct, 2A is not matching 3B, all that they cannot do. So special matters only can be investigated. Show cause notice has to be issued. Once show cause notice is issued, within 30 days, whatever was seized has to be given back. If show cause notice is not going to be given back, then they have to return back the things seized. So look at it from that point of view. Taxpayer has enough safeguards. Now there is an interesting aspect for us to touch upon. We have not concluded 67. We're still in 67. Some more time we have to discuss 67. Please recognize, they will come search whatever they'll feel like, they will take and go. Can you tell them what to take, what not to take? You cannot tell. INS-2 has to be issued in a particular manner. They have to issue an order of seizure in a particular manner. In the order of seizure, they will specifically cover. They will specifically cover how it has to be seized, what has to be seized, what should not be seized, how it will be relevant. At the time of taking everything and going, they may not have the time to sort out and take. They may just take everything and go. Then they have to decide whether they still want to keep it or they can return it back as no longer required for their purpose. Friends, please be very, very careful. INS-2 has to have certain ingredients. First, there should be a detailed inventory prepared. Second, there must be two witnesses, panchas as they're called. Two pancha witnesses have to be there. People of repute, people who know, who witness the proceedings. It cannot be departmental officers only. It cannot normally be the assessee also. Maybe the accountant, maybe the neighboring shop person. Somebody will be called, two pancha witnesses. If pancha witnesses are not there, department has to take two witnesses and go when they're going for inspection. So the witnesses will sign and INS-2 will be issued. Now you have to sit and analyze INS-2. What have they taken? What have they not taken? From what they have taken, what conclusion they can come? So, as chartered accountants, in case clients are inspected, there is no need to urgently go, no, this is not emergency casualty ward. This is not normal, right? Let them finish their work and go. Let them finish their work and go. Seize whatever they want to go. Let them seize and go. If you look at section 6710 says, provisions of section 165 of CRPC will be applicable. Provision of section 165 of CRPC will be applicable to all search proceedings under this act. And the word magistrate referred to in 165 will be replaced with the word commissioner in these proceedings. Friends, when you go to CRPC, how a police will conduct a raid, all those safeguards, procedures, provisions are made applicable to GST. So as chartered accountants, we need to read certain provisions of CRPC also. 99, 41, 49, 59, 99, 100, 101, 165. That's only about 165. I also don't know much about this. I am also studying, like all of us are learning this new law together. I am also learning from each other's experience. We will understand better. 165(5), it says, on an application to the magistrate, all the documents pertaining to the investigation and the search have to be handed over to the accused. You understand? So therefore, taxpayers, whenever an inspection is conducted, department can give show cause notice, they don't give show cause notice, they have a further investigation to do, they don't have any investigation, you don't bother. Under section 6710, make an application to the commissioner. Make an application to the commissioner, simple application. Sir, please give me all the statutory forms issued in respect of case number so and so. Please give me copy of all the file notings in relation to this investigation. If you look at the Radhakrishnan Industries versus State of Himachal Pradesh Supreme Court decision, what Supreme Court order contains, they have cut paste the file. See, in the file notings in Himachal Pradesh, it was written by hand. Some joint commissioner has written by hand, signed. Some 3 pages he has written by hand. The handwritten file notings, they have cut paste in the Supreme Court decision. So friends, under 6710, make an application to the commissioner, read with section 165(5) of CRPC, asking him to give you all the documents. Whatever documents he will give, he has to give INS-1. INS-1 plus file notings before issuing INS-1. See, while issuing INS-1, what happens? Normally, office members who are familiar with department proceedings, you will know, the assistant commissioner will get some secret information, maybe competitor, maybe neighbor, maybe supplier, maybe your employee, maybe your customer, maybe some other CBDT data, something they will get. They will make a file note saying so and so thing are taken place in so and so unit. It will go to the assistant deputy commissioner. He will say, okay, let us discuss this tomorrow. That will be discussed. Then they will have a discussion. Then he will say, you get some more documentary evidence regarding all this information you have gathered. All that will be compiled, that will now be put up to the joint commissioner. I think all the reason to believe is there that he has suppressed, he has claimed credit beyond entitlement, he has indulged in contravention. Some of these 3 things will be there, that will be put up before joint commissioner. Joint commissioner will write on the file saying not satisfied, please give more justification. Some more justification, 2-page justification will be given. To that joint commissioner will say, why don't you add 3 more grounds? So this discussion will go on, and finally the joint commissioner, okay, I am convinced by you. That he cannot say. In the file, the joint commissioner has to record why he is convinced. Please bear in mind, barium chemicals. Reasons should be there, but Supreme Court will not get into those reasons. But if reasons itself is not there, everything is null and void. So therefore, what happens? The joint commissioner should write in the file, for these reasons, this information is there, discussion taken place. Therefore, now I am satisfied that there are reasons to believe that the taxable person has suppressed a supply or stock, has claimed credit greater than entitlement, has indulged in evasion of tax. Therefore, inspection should be done. Inspection should be done at so-and-so address, so-and-so address, so-and-so address. He needs to specify what are the locations. Who is the person, taxable person referring to? ABC Private Limited, ABC Partnership Firm, ABC HUF. Can it be that way? Not possible. Particular GST number has to be identified and specified. Now in 6710, read with 165.5 of CRPC, when you make an application to the commissioner, commissioner has to make xerox copy of everything and give you copy. So friends, you understand now, whenever there is an inspection, don't be in any fear or anxiety, cooperate, let the department do whatever they want. After they have done whatever they want to do, now you take your first step forward under 6710. Till then, keep quiet. Don't do anything. 6710, first step. You will take a first step under 6710, asking for information. Now what will happen? You may get nothing or you may get many things. If you get nothing, file RTI. File RTI, because this is an official record, everything has to be given. What I suggest, in the 6710 application itself, last sentence, I prefer to add, taxpayer has the right to information contained in the files of the public authority. Therefore, to in the interest of justice, we are making this application under 6710, read with 165.5 of CRPC. Officer will understand immediately, oh, these people are talking about RTI Act, so therefore I will not violate anybody's rights, and they will definitely. And I'm telling you, friends, from my experience, 100% of the cases, commissioner will give you all the documents. Nobody will withhold any documents. You will get all the information. Now you sit and study. Okay, so and so thing happened. This accountant only went and told all this information. Now I should ask for cross examination of that accountant. See, please bear in mind, somebody giving complaint is not reason to believe. Somebody's complaint, if it is acted upon, it amounts to abdication of thinking, non-application of mind. That person has done all the thinking, so why I should do the thinking? No. Joint commissioner should think. DC also cannot think. DC will think. He will put up the file. He will argue the case before the JC. The JC has to consider the pros and cons and then come to a conclusion that yes, I think this is a fit case for doing inspection as well as search. Now, I am manufacturing computers. In the INS 1 part C, it says there may be gold biscuits. See, therefore, there is a non-application of mind. So under 6710, please collect all the documents and analyze these documents. In the meanwhile, department can give show cause notice or they don't give show cause notice. Don't bother. As soon as show cause notice comes, you ask for adjournment. Don't reply, because you have to study the file. How can you reply to the show cause notice? So therefore, friends, please keep in mind, inspection is a tremendously important activity, and there are tremendous taxpayer safeguards there is a huge risk the taxpayers are forgetting their rights. I see so many notices, officers are not understanding, taxpayers are on 2A versus 3B, classification, exemption, valuation, adjustment, discount, no discount, debit note, credit note, 17.5, 42-43 reversal. How can these items be a matter of 67? It cannot be. But the problem is, especially state officers, not central. Central, I will tell you why. Especially state officers, I will tell you why. State officers have, jurisdictional officer is different, anti-evasion is different, enforcement is different, vigilance is different, different subgroups are there. So everybody is doing everything. Very sad. And not just sad, I'm trying to make effort to write study material for officers to understand this, conduct a training seminar for them in their training institutes so that they are educated. See, ultimately, nobody benefits by frivolous notices. No revenue will come. All right? Frivolous notices are being issued, so therefore, that is one asset. When you look at these proceedings, normally, our work starts once show cause notice comes. In 67, our work is not in show cause notice. Our work is in reply by commissioner under 6710. Please keep this aspect very clear. Show cause notice, how you will reply, what grounds you will say, etc. Very briefly, I will touch upon. We don't have time. We have to get into 130, 68, and 68 and 120. We will touch upon those provisions in the limited time that we have. When you look at show cause notice under 67, Please keep in mind, if there is a frivolous notice on routine matters, I don't say a notice is frivolous, the matters are routine, please question jurisdiction. Now, chartered accountants, I know as a fellow member of the institute, as in a fellow professional colleague, I understand, I was totally ignorant about this concept of administrative law. Administrative law is an unwritten law. There is no act called Administrative Law Act. Just like there is no law called Tort Act, law of tort, there is no act. Just like that, administrative law, there is no act. It is an unwritten law, but a salutary law. Administrative law is a subject that we are necessarily required to read a little bit to understand how a society functions. A society that is barbaric does not have rule of law. If there is no law, then anybody can do whatever they want. See, I'll tell you what, ultimately, see, you're not paying tax. 2A is now is less than 3B, so you're not paying tax correctly. Forget all the sections, I will give show cause notice. Then what we will do, we will just delete this act after section 52. Up to 652 is important, isn't it? TDS, TCS. Then rest we will delete. Delete it off. We will all get into other areas of practice. Let department do whatever they want to do. If the parliament says this law will be implemented in this manner, then that wish of the parliament, everybody has to fulfill. The government has to follow what the parliament has said. The taxpayer also has to follow what the parliament has said. When the parliament has said that certain things will be done in a certain manner, then all things have to be done in that manner or not at all done. This is not only for tax department, it is also for taxpayer. Taxpayer also cannot do whatever he likes. So therefore, my humble submission for members is, any book on administrative law, please take a few topics in administrative law to understand what is this concept of rule of law. And you yourself will feel very confident to question the question. See, we all are excited to answer the question. The most important thing in GST is to question the question. If you don't question the question, then you can never question the question later. So first to question the question, then you can give answer to the question. Sir, answer to the question everybody will give. Let me tell you a little secret. Whatever answer you give, as an officer, I will confirm the demand only. I'm sure nobody is surprised. Whatever answer you give, I will not accept your answer. Why? Because I am not sure of the answer. How can I agree with you? How can I agree with you? What if tomorrow something different comes out? So I will not agree with you. My job is to confirm the demand, send you to first appeal. Isn't it? So therefore, please be tremendously careful. Don't think that you will give an answer, it will be accepted and it will be concluded. We are used to this one-day cricket match. We don't like five-day matches. In fact, now one day also, we cannot spend only 3 hours in a 20-20 match. Evening toss, by dinner time, result also out. That is how we want. Maybe slowly it will become five hours, then afterwards sometime, maybe only toss and then give the cup. That's how it will become. In GST, please keep in mind, it is a test match. Result will come only day five. First, they will get batting, you will do bowling. Then you will get batting, they will do bowling. Then again, you will get second innings also. So please be very careful. All right. Officer, first of all, is not going to accept any answer he gives. We touch upon 65 for 1 minute. 65, I see a lot of members giving wrong answers, the detailed calculation, VLOOKUP, power lookup. So many calculation, Excel, portrait, landscape, so many things we are doing and giving for audit. Do you think an audit officer from the department is coming to do the audit to give a clean chit and go? Or is he coming to do the audit, keeping you as a risky taxpayer in mind with an objective to book a case and go? What is it? See, we are all in auditors. We understand. When you go for internal audit, I remember when during my articleship days, in internal audit, partner will tell you, please do proper audit and come. 3 months, we will go and do some audit and come. At least if nothing is there, we will say revenue stamp is not affixed in the payment voucher. See, I have to give my report to partner. In my report, I will say revenue stamp not affixed in the payment voucher and give my report. And I will make annexure. How many vouchers are there which is not having revenue stamp? My goal is to find mistake, isn't it? Now you come to 67. What is the goal? The goal is not to verify. The goal is with a preconception, reason to believe that there is an evasion of tax. How then will an officer who has initiated proceedings under 67 close the file without a show cause notice? Please refer to para number 6. Para number 6 of Circular 31/5/2018, GST, 9th February 2018, the circular very clearly says audit and intelligence commissionerate, DGGI and audit, DG audit, they will do the audit, they will do the investigation, they will issue a notice, but they will not sit and do what is called adjudication. They will transfer the file to the executive commissionerate, and the executive commissionerate should do the adjudication, which means the file must speak. Everything that has happened will be put on the file. So therefore, friends, the question that arises is, did you give the facts or did you give the interpretation of the facts? In 67, please make sure that you have applied for all the documents. Suppose you, well, you, I only, suppose I received a show cause notice under inspection proceedings, 2A-3B, exemption is not correct, valuation is not correct, debit note, credit note is not correct, are the observations. I will give a reply. When I give a reply, whose fault is it that I did not collect all the file notings? Whose fault is it that I did not collect IS-1 copy? Whose fault is it that I did not activate the rights that I have under CRPC? Whose fault? Can you say that it is a duty of the department to give me all this information, prepare me to fight them? Of course it will not. Please bear in mind, in taxation, just like in prosecution, what matter they want to prosecute, what matter they don't want to prosecute is their choice. When you are checking valuation, why are you checking debit note, credit note? When you have already checked the valuation, why did you not check debit note, credit note last time? You cannot ask all those questions. It is the commissioner's choice. Which case he will book, which case he will ignore, what issue he will accept, what issue he will not accept. So therefore, I feel as soon as you get an inspection, prepare for a test match because it is going into appeal. I'll give you a small, quick reference as to how this works. When you get a favorable order, when you receive a favorable order, how long should you wait before celebrating it? Suppose you have got a favorable order, how long should you wait before celebrating? No, why? I got a favorable order, immediately I will start celebrating. Please look at section 1072. Whenever there is a order passed where the department is aggrieved, department is having 6 months time to file an appeal against such a favorable order, favorable to assessee, with the first appellate authority. So therefore, every time you get a favorable order, for 6 months you have to wait. 6 months you have to wait because you never know, department may have gone on appeal. After 6 or 7 months, then you can start celebrating. Now, suppose you have gone on first appeal, and in first appeal you have got a favorable order. Now, how long do you have to wait to celebrate it? First appeal, you got a favorable order. Joint Commission appeals passed an order which is favorable to you. How long should you wait before celebrating? Look at section 1081. It says department has 3 years time to take this favorable order and reverse it in revisionary proceedings under 108. So friends, please keep in mind, if you get an unfavorable order, you are going on appeal. If you get a favorable order, department is going on appeal. If department has, in the first appeal there is a favorable order, department can reverse it in revisionary proceedings. If first appeal you are, if you have received an adverse order, you will go to tribunal. So in GST, the entire issue is going to get resolved only at the tribunal level for a long, long time. Once most of the issues have been decided by the tribunal or courts, then only lower authorities will start following it. So friends, if you think that 67 proceedings have started, I will give justification, I've got CA certificate. How can you make me responsible for the default of my supplier argument you will use? Please bear in mind, this is not the place. Next, 6 to 7 very briefly we have covered, sufficient to just ignite members' interest to get into 67. We haven't covered in more detail 67. Sufficient we have covered. Two more aspects to mention. 67.11, dangerous provision. Suppose I go to the department for some interaction, I bring some documents with me, some contract, some ledger extract, some CA certificate, some customer account confirmation, something I've taken. Spot seizure. 67.11 authorizes spot seizure. What is spot seizure? Then and there, whatever you have brought can be seized and acknowledgement given to you immediately. So friends, don't go to department is my recommendation, because there is no requirement for anyone to go to department, isn't it? When you go to department, don't take your mobile phone, don't take any papers. That is beyond what is required for your purpose. Please be very careful. Spot seizure can be done. For anything else, prior authorization, etc., etc., is required. Who can do spot recovery, spot seizure? Whoever is the officer before whom you are appearing, immediately it can be seized. So please be very, very careful what is being seized. Once seizure is done, then seizure has to ultimately be result in a, it should be used to give a demand in some manner. But please be very, very careful. This section has those powers. 67.12, last subsection, 67.12 touches upon test purchase. What is test purchase? Officer will suddenly come to the shop, buy something for more than 200 rupees to check if you are giving invoice. Recently, one incident took place. Officer visited, purchased something in a medical shop. Invoice was not given. On the packing cover itself, the boy calculated the amount of tax to be paid, amount of payment to be made, and he sent the customer. Officer immediately disclosed his identity and said, you are liable for penalty. While this penalty proceeding was started, officer said, your classification at 5% is wrong, it is liable to 12%. Please bear in mind, test purchase is permitted under 67.12 only for the purpose of testing whether invoice is being issued or not issued. There is nothing else that can be done. So therefore, these two, 67.11 and 12, both don't require any prior authorization. Please be very careful. Now we look at 68. 68 is relevant for what reason? 68 is relevant for e-way bill. I'll give a small illustration about e-way bill as to how facts are not properly understood. There is a generator that was being transported without an invoice. Only DC, no e-way bill, no invoice. Generator is being transported. Everybody knows the market value of the generator is 1 crore rupees. 1 crore rupees is the generator, and the vigilance team of the department intercepted the vehicle and said, please show me the e-way bill. No e-way bill available. Immediately, they took steps to initiate action as to what needs to be done. The question that arises is, show cause notice was issued. When show cause notice is issued, please bear in mind, the reply given to the department was, sir, e-way bill is not applicable to me. Understood? E-way bill is not applicable to me. Once it was explained that e-way bill is not applicable to me, the officer was totally surprised. How come e-way bill is not applicable to you? Please bear in mind, question the question. Department is issued a notice stating e-way bill is not prepared on the assumption that I am selling the generator for 1 crore rupees. The reply given by the taxpayer was, this generator is being given to a film shooting party for one day. The rental for the generator is 30,000 rupees. 30,000 rupees is the daily rental. I am sending today. Tomorrow it will come back. One day, 30,000 rupees. Invoice I will give later. So therefore, below 30,000 rupees, below 50,000 rupees, e-way will not applicable, because rule 138 very clearly said, consignment value is a value as per section 15. Value as per section 15 depends on what is the nature of supply. Who said it is a sale when it was a rental? So therefore, department may have less information, so therefore they may make many assumptions. So it is extremely important for taxpayers to be conscious of the rights of taxpayer. Now under section 68, what can be verified? Vehicle is stopped. Oh, why are you taking this material? Why is the price so less? How come you are taking such a long route? Why you are not taking shortcut? What is the classification? What is the exemption? Are you claiming 12% or 5%? Please bear in mind, 67 is even more limited than 67. 68 is even more limited than 67. 68 only allows verification of whatever documents is specified in rule 138A. Only those rules can be verified, nothing more can be verified. But officers who are intercepting sometimes may travel beyond the scope of section 68, but taxpayer does not know what are the boundaries, so taxpayer will entertain those notices and end up in a trouble. 68 tells us to go to section 129. 129 talks about certain procedure to be followed. When you look at 129, friends, please consider two subsections in 129 very carefully. 129.1. 129.1 gives three choices. You come forward to pay the tax, you don't come forward to pay the tax, or you ask for security, financial security to release the goods and go. I'll put up a small screen, one slide only on the screen for members to see. There's a very beautiful circular number 41, amended by 49, amended by 61, which explains what are the principles that need to be followed to understand the procedure in interception of vehicle. First step is the vehicle will be intercepted and the documents will be inspected. Once the vehicle is intercepted and the documents are verified, immediately a statement is recorded in MOV1 from the person in charge of the conveyance. Who is the person in charge of conveyance? Driver, operator, whoever is the person in charge, a statement will be recorded. As soon as statement is recorded, immediately decision has to be taken whether to inspect the consignment or not. An order has to be passed in MOV2. This also has to be done immediately. You cannot wait for 3-4 days. After MOV2, the status has to be updated online in EWB3 Part A. Within 24 hours of interception, this Part A report has to be uploaded. Now, in case this 24 hours is not sufficient, all right, extension has to be sought by filing MOV3. MOV3 is a form for filing extension. Within 3 days or within the time of extension granted, inspection should be completed and a report prepared in MOV4 and updated online in EWB3 Part B. Friends, please keep this image in mind. The reason is the truck driver or the person transporting, merchant shipping department, sales department, whoever is involved, are rarely aware of the taxpayer's rights and safeguards. Department now has to issue an order for release under MOV5. No discrepancy is there. Recently, we saw an incident where MOV5 is given saying no discrepancy, but then show cause notice is issued demanding some penalty. If you want provisional release, you remember 67.6, which we talked about regarding provisional release. Provisional release is allowed to release provisionally. An application has to be made. Normally, there is no reason to reject provisional release. You have to immediately allow it. If he is saying that I will give a bond, please release it to me. Why you want to keep it in the highway and take responsibility for it? Provisional release also will be ordered in MOV8 and a bond will be executed in MOV8 will be the bond, provisional release in MOV5. Once this is done, an order of detention is passed in MOV6. Whenever an order is passed, please bear in mind it has to be with reasons, MOV6. Show cause notice is given in MOV7. What is the show cause notice going to say? Show cause notice will say why penalty under 129 should not be imposed. Please keep in mind classification issue, valuation issue, input tax credit issue, exemption issue, packing issue, none of those issues, only 138A and nothing else. Registered person, e-vehicle is there, DC is there, or invoice is there, that is sufficient. Nothing further needs to be verified. Once show cause notice is issued, order will be passed in MOV 9. But if you notice, friends, in this representation diagrammatically, the truck driver is attending to all these matters. I want to draw your attention. Please pause here. Don't read anything further. I will pause and draw your attention to section 129.1c. All transporters need to educate their customers to send the transporter with one letter saying, if any vehicle is intercepted, please request that goods should be released. So a 129.1c letter should be given. That means I want to give security and release the goods. Don't create tension demanding payment of penalty. 129.1c request letter should be accompanied. In case the goods are detained, that is MOV 6 is issued, please file for provisional release. Provisional release also is permitted in section 129.2, where you request that it has to be released. Now in Finance Act 2021, provisional release 129.2 is proposed to be omitted, which means your request for 129.1c itself is sufficient to release your goods. Make a request and let them issue a show cause notice. Show cause notice has to be very carefully issued. It cannot be very lightly issued. Once show cause notice is issued, reply will be given. Because of provision release, vehicle has already moved on. Now you can reply, give answers, give evidence, whatever order they want to pass, they can pass order, you can file appeal and proceed further. Whenever penalty is confirmed under 129, confiscation proceedings have to be initiated under 130. So therefore, another notice in MOV 10 will be issued within 14 days of MOV 6. Another order will be issued in MOV 10. So please keep in mind, show cause notice in MOV 7 does not give you 3 months time to reply, maximum 14 days. So as soon as MOV 6 is passed, show cause notice will be issued. Confiscation proceedings also will be initiated. In case confiscation order is passed, please bear in mind, order will be passed under MOV 11 and MOV 9 order will be withdrawn from the proceedings. So please bear in mind, we need to recognize how exactly department will take action. The basis for us to identify this process is in the circulars issued by the board. Now, members sitting back may be wondering, where will we have time to attend to all this? My reference to section 68 is one to give information. But more importantly, please understand the limits to the authority taxpayers have. Any proceeding, I told you in the beginning, three-step reply. We have received your communication dated so-and-so. We dispute the proceedings and reject the demand. And we rely on section 160 subsection 2 to entertain these kinds of proceedings. So therefore, please bear in mind, which section, what action is decided in the section itself. To travel beyond the section means there is no authority. Authority means there is no jurisdiction to take any such action. So when you look at 68, 65 is so wide, 67 is so limited, 68 is even more limited as far as what proceedings can be initiated. 130 we will briefly touch upon and come back to 67 to identify what such proceedings will be done. Confiscation, very quickly, difference between seizure and confiscation is anything can be seized, but only goods liable for confiscation can be confiscated. Now, to decide whether something is liable for confiscation or not, careful study of the facts is necessary. So in order to confiscate, first there will be a seizure. Then decision is taken that confiscation is to be done. So friends, what is the purpose of seizure? Seizure is to identify what is to be confiscated. Confiscation cannot be blindly gone. They suddenly come and select and confiscate. No, whenever they inspect or whenever it is intercepted, first seizure, then application of mind, then notice for confiscation. If you look at section 130, subsection 1, there are 5 reasons given. Only 5 reasons where the articles are liable for confiscation. Articles liable for confiscation, only 5 reasons are there. When you analyze, you will identify what exactly are those 5 reasons. If you travel beyond those, suppose there's a classification dispute. Suppose there is a registration, whether it's applicable or not, is in doubt. If you look at another very beautiful master circular issued under Central Excise, circular number 1053/2/2017 CX, dated 10th March 2017. 1053/2/2017 CX, dated 10th March 2017. You will find that the master circular says, because it is based on the national litigation policy, the master circular contains many taxpayer safeguards. Whenever there is a new interpretation being canvassed by the revenue, whenever there is a new interpretation being canvassed by the revenue, there cannot be an allegation of fraud or suppression. See, I have interpreted in a particular manner, you are interpreting in a different manner. Where is the question of saying there is a evasion of tax? To issue a show cause notice under section 74, it may be issued very easily by making an allegation that there is fraud, willful misrepresentation or suppression with an intention to evade payment of tax. But if you look at section 75(2), you will see whenever a show cause notice is issued under section 74 and the special circumstances for issuing notice under 74 are not established, then such a show cause notice will be deemed to be a show cause notice under section 73. So friends, there are many safeguards that a taxpayer has, but the trouble is the taxpayer does not want to protect those safeguards and utilize those safeguards. So when you look at section 130, when there is a proposal to confiscate something, anything cannot be confiscated. Everything that can be confiscated must first be seized. To seize it, it must be available. So suppose I have sold certain goods, I have not paid GST. Department comes to know that I have suppressed my turnover, so they will take action under 67, issue a show cause notice. Can they do confiscation? They cannot do that. Can they go to my customer's shop and confiscate the goods? Not possible. Not possible. If you look at section 122(3)(c) and (d), you will find goods and services that are received, only penalty can be charged. So friends, please keep in mind, confiscation cannot be done blindly. Penalty, I'm sure some faculty will be discussing with you. When you look at confiscation, only 5 situations: supply goods or receive goods in contravention of act. Supply goods or receive goods in contravention of act. Do not account the goods on which I am liable to pay tax. What am I liable to pay tax on? Goods which I have supplied on forward charge basis, or goods which I have received liable on reverse charge basis. Is services covered? No. Goods are only covered. Supplies or receives goods in contravention of act. Do not account for the goods. Supply goods liable to tax without registration. Failure to register. If I have made a mistake in understanding the definition of aggregate turnover, is it sufficient to confiscate? No. Interpretational differences cannot become reason to establish evasion of tax. I'll deviate a little, touch upon one aspect in income tax. I don't get into income tax provisions, but it is relevant for GST. There is an assessee where the prosecution proceedings under 276 was launched. The ground in the income tax prosecution case was there was a disallowance in the assessment and the assessee has not filed appeal. He has effectively accepted the disallowance, so therefore there is evasion of income tax. There Supreme Court says in one decision, I forget what is that decision, I have not registered it. Supreme Court says, not objecting to the disallowance is not admission for purpose of prosecution. Prosecution is a different setting. Add back of expenditure or disallowance of certain expenditure, etc., and acceptance or failure to file appeal is not sufficient for prosecution. So when you look at it, registration is important, but registration by interpretation that it is not applicable is not sufficient to support confiscation. Knowing fully well that I have to register, I am not registering. Next, contravention of any provision of the act with an intention to evade payment of tax. This is not so wide. It cannot be limitless. It is sufficient that the device that I employ should result in evasion of tax. How will they confiscate something if I contravene the provision? The fruits of the contravention must be seized. Friends, confiscation not possible without seizure. To seize, one of the grounds is goods liable for confiscation, and contravention of the act to evade payment of tax, the fruits of such contravention should be seized. If the fruits have been eaten, then there cannot be any confiscation. So please keep that in mind. The last aspect is when you use any conveyance as a means of transportation to result in any evasion of tax, then the conveyance itself can be confiscated. Friends, we have to look at section 130 subsection 2. I won't go into the rest of 130 subsection 2 because of the issues that we need to identify and discuss. So let's look at what aspects are important to consider. When you are looking at confiscation, department will not directly pass an order saying confiscation, because confiscation means the title will pass to the department. Title will pass to the government. So therefore, you have a provision in section 130 subsection 2 giving an opportunity to pay penalty in lieu of confiscation. So this is called redemption fine. You have confiscated my stock. I want to take back the stock. So therefore, I will give you monetary fine so that you can release back the goods to me. Please keep in mind, ultimately what is the penalty department is interested in? Equal to the tax. If that much they are able to get in the form of redemption fine, there is no occasion to confiscate the property. So therefore, there is a question regarding confiscation. Confiscation, whenever it is triggered, there is two prerequisites. First, there must be a seizure. Whether provisionally released or not provisionally released does not matter. Seizure is important. Second, opportunity to pay redemption fine must be given. In order to give this opportunity, what is important is department should issue a show cause notice. Let me tell you a little secret. Based on my own personal mistakes, friends, when I'm speaking with you about all these topics, it is not to say that I'm very wise about these matters. I am probably the one who has committed the most number of mistakes. Realizing my mistakes, I am sharing it with you so that you don't make those mistakes. Department has a practice, particularly in customs, to ask the assessee for waiver of show cause notice, waiver of appeal. How it will be presented, I will tell you. Okay, you are liable for confiscation, penalty, etc. will be charged. So what we will do is we will settle this matter. We will settle it. I will put up the file with my boss, and most reasonably we will close this case. Why unnecessarily notice, penalty, appeal, etc.? Just give me a letter saying you don't want show cause notice, you don't want to file appeal, I will close the case. This is the biggest trick. I have also fallen prey to this trick. Please bear in mind, don't give up your rights to show cause notice. No, sir. Ultimately, somebody is going to decide. We had a refresher course in our branch. We learned that it is a test match. It is not a 2020 match. So don't worry, you give me notice. But I will settle it. I will tell my boss, sir, you, your boss, all that doesn't matter, sir. Because anyway, if I get a favorable order, you will go on appeal. If I get an adverse order, I will go on appeal. So anyway, appeal is guaranteed. So therefore, don't bother about all this. Give me notice. In the show cause notice, they have to lay down all the ingredients. Friends, let me just touch upon this aspect since we're talking about ingredients. Section 75.7, which is very important, it says, 75.6 says the grounds and the facts and the basis, the facts and the basis for giving the show cause notice must be specified in the show cause notice. 75.7 says the grounds on which the show cause notice is issued, adjudication should be made on those grounds only and no other grounds. Adjudication should be made on those grounds only and no other grounds, which means adjudicating authority, in his wisdom and experience, he cannot say, these grounds are not good. I will give three extra grounds which are very, make the case very strong. Strong light, this is not, we are not making tea here. the grounds that is there in the show cause notice, only those grounds you should confirm the demand. If you look at section 107.11, second proviso, even the first appellate authority, when he comes to know some additional liability is there, he cannot confirm the demand. He has to send it for fresh show cause notice under 73.74. So therefore, friends, when a confiscation is proposed, a show cause notice has to be given to confiscate, MOV 11, to confiscate as well as to confiscate as well as to give an option to pay redemption fine. It should be proposed what should be the redemption fine. Redemption fine should meet what is called the ends of justice. Redemption fine cannot be issued charging a tax which is so enormous, charging a tax which is so enormous that the person has to shut down his business. That does not meet the ends of justice. If you look at circular number 61, all right, and if I recollect it right, it is circular number 61. Regarding e-way bill, very clearly what the law specifies is, when you circular number 64, circular number 64 very clearly says, minor offenses in e-way bill context, circular number 64 says minor offenses. When there are minor offenses, circular itself says charge 500 rupees penalty. When 500 rupees penalty is to be charged, then you can identify therein that there is a policy of the government to have discretion, when how much penalty, when how much fine must be charged. So therefore, friends, please keep in mind, when such seizure proceedings are being carried out, it must conclude in a show cause notice. Show cause notice may result in demand or may result in confiscation and therefore redemption fine instead of confiscation. When you go back to section 67, now we will identify some of the key points that we have touched upon because that's the extent of time that is available. When you look at any search proceedings, please don't merge everything. What we have heard about in income tax, what we have experienced in VAT or sales tax, what we have seen in films. Normally, many times you come across knowledge about customs or search, etc. We think of films where any famous actor has acted like a customs officer or an income tax officer, suddenly come and conduct a raid. Please stop all of those. You have attended refresher course, you are knowledgeable, you are aware of GST law. 67.1 requires reasons to believe in three specific cases for a taxable person and two specific cases for other person. The reasons to believe must pre-exist and predate INS-1. The reasons to believe must be documented in INS-1 or it must be recorded in the files before grant of INS-1. INS-1 contains part C as regards what seizure is to be, search is to be done. Therefore, the reasons to believe goods liable for confiscation or documents, books or things have been secreted must also be contained in the files at the time of issue of show cause notice and issue of INS-1. Taxpayer needs to only cooperate. Taxpayer is not required to get agitated and raise new questions. We touch upon a few decisions about search and seizure which have thrown a lot of light and enlightened us in our understanding of these proceedings. First, if there are no reasons, no proceedings. Even if there is a legitimate discovery, nothing can be done. The reasons cannot be suspicions. The reason must be by an application of mind, careful consideration. They must analyze what has taken place, what is the conclusion, how they came to this conclusion must be very clearly considered. I'll give a small decision, reference to decision in the case of S. Naranappa and others versus CIT, very old decision, year 1967. The belief must be held in good faith. It cannot be merely a pretense. To put it differently, it is open to the court to examine the question whether the reasons for the belief have a rational connection or a relevant bearing to the forming of the belief and are not extraneous or irrelevant to the purpose of the section. So it is tremendously important to identify how they came to this conclusion. It is not something that someone suddenly decides. Now, if the reasons to believe have to be compelling to take this action, Friends, please consider what happens in such a case, how taxpayer has to question this. How taxpayer has to question this. Very clearly, we have seen taxpayer has safeguards in section 6710 that entire principles under CRPC will be applicable to these proceedings. When principles of CRPC are applicable, taxpayer has to remain quiet. He should not make unnecessary noise. He should cooperate with the search proceedings. I have seen a few instances in GST where search proceedings are being carried out. Taxpayer is very nervous. Taxpayer is very nervous. Some of my friends, when I'm discussing with them that one of their client, there has been a inspection and later a search and seizure has been done. The client is having high BP. They give medical report to the department asking for additional time. Let me share this with you, friends. Don't do all these things. Leave it. Don't get tension. Not only the client is under stress. My friend, that the chartered accountant also is having high BP. Chartered accountant also no sleep, no food. His wife is telephoning and complaining that this man is not able to rest properly at home. Please bear in mind, as chartered accountants, as soon as the proceeding is initiated, the law is set in motion, isn't it? The law is set in motion. Is this the end of the proceeding? We all understand that this is not the end of the proceeding. Some of the aspects we have touched upon. I would submit that chartered accountants must conduct themselves like a surgeon. You see a surgeon, very calm, composed. Surgeon does not get nervous when he sees the x-ray. What will the surgeon say? Okay, nothing to worry. Only hand is broken. All the pieces are inside only. We can do surgery. Don't worry. Please maintain composure. Reason why we have to maintain composure is self-incrimination. Self-incrimination. What is self-incrimination? Article 20, sub-article 3 of the Constitution says no accused person shall be a witness against himself. You know about this Miranda rights, Miranda versus State of Arizona. In movies, English movies, you may have seen where they, before arresting, they will read the rights. You have a right to remain silent. Anything you say can and will be used in a court of law. The court will provide you with a legal representation, etc., etc. So they were referred to in America as Miranda rights. In India also, we have this principle in Article 20, sub-article 3, stating that the taxpayer, that the accused cannot, has a right to remain silent. He need not confess everything. That is what is provided in Article 20, sub-article 3. Now, if you come to GST, friends, taxation is totally different. In taxation, there is no protection for the taxpayer from self-incrimination. If the department asks you any question, you give answer. If it is against you, you cannot say, I will keep quiet, I don't give you answer. That is not possible. There is a long list of judgments that can be examined to consider this one aspect. I briefly touch upon a few points for you to kindly consider. In Evidence Act, there are provisions from section 24 to section 30, which say any statement made before a police officer is not an admissible evidence. So therefore, whatever you want, you can tell the police officer. They will file the police report under 173, and later you can go to the magistrate and say, all that I never told, this fellow was beating me, that is why I told whatever I told. Otherwise, he is not releasing me also, therefore I told all these things. I was afraid that he will beat me. Many things. He said he will release me if I tell what happened against all the other accused person. For these reasons, there is a protection in section 24 to 30 of Evidence Act 1872. The protection available under Evidence Act before a police officer, is it available in GST against a GST officer is a question. So there are a number of judgments. The most recent judgment is Tufan Singh versus State of Tamil Nadu. Supreme Court decision, Justice Nariman has rendered a very wonderful decision. If you get the time and the interest, I would encourage you to please download anywhere Tufan Singh versus State of Tamil Nadu and read this judgment, because the reason why I'm encouraging you to read this decision is because it traces the history from the beginning, what happened, some decisions, collector of customs versus Elias, state of West Bengal versus Ramesh Chandra Mehta, all these decisions have been traced finally to come to the conclusion that GST officer is not a police officer. Therefore, whatever you say before a GST officer can be used as evidence. But please look at section 136. 136 of GST law says statement made before a tax officer in prosecution proceedings will have no relevance unless the court believes it wants to accept it. There are five situations where the person giving a statement has expired before the trial commences. That time the court can accept the statement. But if the person is alive, then the court will have to call that person and record his statement afresh. So therefore, friends, when dealing with the search proceedings, there is no reason to be afraid what to say. I told you three things I will tell you in this context. Cooperate. Don't worry, cooperate, nothing will happen. Second, give facts, don't interpret facts. Furnish the facts, don't furnish the interpretation of those facts. Know the difference when you are furnishing the facts, when you are furnishing the interpretation of the facts. Have you executed this contract? Yes, we have executed the contract. Have you paid the GST? No, we have not paid the GST. Why you have not paid the GST? Now interpretation. Why I have not paid the GST is because GST is not payable. If I give explanation, it is no longer facts. There was one incident where a doctor was called as an expert witness. Doctor was called as an expert witness in a criminal trial. And the judge asked the doctor, how did the patient die? The doctor said, my lord, the victim has been murdered. So the judge told the doctor, you get out of here. It is murder or not, I will decide. You as an expert, you only tell me whether the victim died by suffocation, heart attack, head injury, how he died, you tell me. See, murder is an interpretation of law. So in search proceedings, please furnish the facts. You don't have to furnish the interpretation of the facts. Third aspect, when any statement is being called for, please examine. There is no procedure in section 67. We have surveyed from 67.1 to 67.12, we have gone through. There is no proceeding in 67 where question answer session can be conducted. Although the instructions given 2nd of February 2020, instruction number one, it says questions can be asked, but please bear in mind, questions can be asked only under section 70. In section 70, a statement or evidence can be called for to provide responses. So therefore, please keep in mind, summons proceedings under section 70 is important because it is a very close sister provision to search. In summons proceedings, what we have to bear in mind is who should ask questions, what questions can be asked, what questions cannot be asked. I'll give you small examples to highlight how this happens. Summons proceedings are conducted to collect an evidence or to record a statement. A document or evidence is to be collected. In a summons, normally some documents are required, so summons will be given, some documents will be provided. If evidence is required, a person will be called to come and record a statement. When a statement is being recorded, it is normally question answer session. They will put a question, you will give an answer, it will be written down, then one more question, then one more answer. That is how question answer will go. Have you entered in, suppose the MD of the company is called, and the question is, have you entered into such a contract? Answer, yes, we have entered into such a contract. Is GST payable on the contract? I don't know. Please bear in mind, the MD of the company cannot know whether GST is paid. The finance manager will know whether GST is paid or not. Finance manager will not know why GST is not paid, because why GST is not paid is an interpretation of law. The only instruction given to the finance manager is on this contract, GST not applicable, so don't pay GST. Please identify who can give and what statement can that person give. A person cannot go beyond the scope of the authority he has. Recently, there was an incident where statement given by the director was attached to the show cause notice and an order was passed. And a notice was issued demanding tax. The question was, In reply to the show cause notice, the ground was taken that, sir, the director of the company joined the company in April 2019. Statement made by the director about a transaction before joining the company cannot be admissible as evidence in these proceedings. That's all. If you remove the statement of the director in the show cause notice, that is, there is nothing but an assumption, an alternate argument that is being canvassed by the department. So therefore, please bear in mind, the question comes from these kinds of instances. So when you look at section 67 proceedings, there is no scope for any question answer except under section 70. And in section 70, when questions and answers are being taken up, it is important to identify how those provision questions are being put, what questions are being put, whether that question is something within the authority of the person to be knowledgeable about. If the MD is asked questions about taxation, or if the tax manager is asked questions about production procedure, those are all beyond the scope of authority. Next, even if a person gives an answer, please be very careful. The statement made can be corrected, retracted, withdrawn within reasonable time. So the reply to the show cause notice itself will contain a section, a portion on retractions of statements made. So please bear in mind, when you look at show cause notice, you've had this session already, you have understood what are the various components of a show cause notice, what are the taxpayer safeguards under section 75 in respect of show cause notice. Therefore, when you look at a show cause notice, please bear in mind, search proceedings is not demand proceedings. Search proceedings are not demand proceedings. In demand proceedings, notice, etc. will follow. In search proceedings, investigation is going on. What can be investigated? When you look at what can be investigated, we have discussed at reasonable length, routine matters cannot easily become part of search proceedings. Only specific things can be taken up in search proceedings. During a search proceedings, again, to reiterate some of the points which we have not touched upon earlier, breaking open a cupboard, etc., we have seen, provisional release we have identified. And when you look at disposal of provisional of perishable articles, please bear in mind, friends, this one instance I will share with you. There is a assessee who is registered for at the factory. Factory is in one place, and in the main busy commercial area, they are having showroom. The assessee, in his misunderstanding, what he has done, GST registration migration is done for the factory. Previously, they were having excise registration. Factory address is migrated to GST. Showroom address is not added in GST. Showroom address is not added in GST. Department collected information that there is sales taking place in the showroom. They came in, inspected, searched, passed seizure order, and even disposed of the article under 67(8). Disposal was done. Total amount of market value of the goods was 13 lakhs. Some tobacco, arecanut, those sort of provisional articles, perishable articles were there. So the total tax collected was 13 lakhs. Party paid this money. Then department issued a show cause notice imposing a penalty of 130 lakhs penalty was imposed in respect of these proceedings. The short point that was taken up by this party is, the short point taken up was, the showroom was not secreted for the following three reasons. Three reasons was given why it was not secreted. First, the showroom is in the public area. It is not in any concealed location. Second, the stock in the showroom is accounted as purchases in the books of accounts. The sales made in the showroom are disclosed in the 3B of every month and applicable taxes disclosed. The only violation that is noticed was additional premises has not been added in the certificate of registration. And finally, when the proceeding was concluded by the commissioner, 10,000 penalty per address was imposed and the entire proceedings were quashed. please bear in mind, it is important for the taxpayer to identify what reasons. If the taxpayer had proceeded to admit that there was a violation attracting penalty of 1.3 crores, then perhaps the discussion would have gone under section 74(9). You are aware the penalty is 50% of the entire tax. So therefore, they may have imposed a significant amount of penalty of about 7.5 lakhs on the tax itself. And in respect of confiscation, the penalty could have been in lakhs, if not in crores. So therefore, look at it from this point of view, taxpayers' rights have to be very carefully and very fiercely guarded. What is important is to identify exactly how these proceedings are carried out. Now, coming back to touch upon how proceedings are currently being carried out, all routine matters are taken up through 67. Now, in an instance where routine matters are taken up in proceedings under 67, what should the taxpayer do? Taxpayer need to reply on the technical issue of jurisdiction and not reply on merits. What will happen if you reply on merits? You understand very clearly, if you reply on merits, the technical objections will be considered but not considered, and the merits will be answered later in appeal. You will know that those issues will ultimately boil down as confirmation of demand. So when you look at it from this point of view, please be very careful. The commencement of any response is to question the question. When you look at such proceedings, please take some time to do some comparative reading of other legislations where such proceedings are taken up, to identify where exactly department is taking action, what kind of powers are given there. Briefly, I have referred to 147 of income tax, just to give you a contrast, just a flavor of how customs GST law can operate differently from income tax. Now, I'll share with you two aspects. Section 132 of income tax, if you read, I'm sure members are familiar with the section. 132 of income tax says where the principal director general or so-and-so, in consequence of information in his possession, has reason to believe that any person, etc., etc., has done. So identify what gives the jurisdiction. If you finish foundation, we can go to do intermediate. When we finish intermediate, then we can go to do final. At intermediate itself, if the student is very brilliant and he knows many things in final, he will not get jurisdiction to go and answer final paper. He has to go through the process. So therefore, we have to identify. But then you have a contrast where if a taxpayer fails to question the jurisdiction, then the taxpayer will be never permitted to raise these questions in subsequent proceedings. So therefore, friends, it is tremendously important to identify whether the proceedings that we are looking at is legally valid or not. Many instances we will come across where such proceedings are done in a very routine manner. Take another instance. We look at section 133A of Income Tax Act, where it says an income tax officer may enter any place within the limits of the area assigned to him and require any proprietor to afford him an necessary facility to inspect such books of accounts. Now you look back and see, to do anything, specific power must be given. If the power is not given, then the doing of that thing amounts to legislating. The passion to protect interests of revenue do not permit the department to rewrite the law. They are only supposed to read the law, implement the law. They cannot rewrite the law and implement the new law that they have rewritten. That amounts to entering the domain of legislature. The parliament will make the law, executive will implement the law, judiciary will interpret the law. Judiciary should not make the law, parliament should not interpret the law, executive should not rewrite the law. When you look at it from this point of view, one issue comes up. We have sufficient amount of time. I'll try and finish about 10 minutes or 15 minutes earlier to see if there are some questions, although I don't expect many questions relating to this aspect, because I'm sure members are now hopefully enthused to go back and get into this subject more deeply to enrich your own understanding and examination of the provision in the light of your experience, I want to touch upon a few aspects just very quickly for you to get a good appreciation of how this search proceedings need to be carried out. Please bear in mind, an officer cannot do what is called a roving inquiry. Please come and tell me what all you are doing. I want to first study what you are doing. Not all. Whether I have done something correctly or incorrectly, you cannot interfere with what I am doing, because it amounts to stepping into Section 59. Section 59 says self-assessment, which means who? I will assess. I will assess. You will scrutinize the return under 61. You will do best judgment under 62, 63. You will do summary assessment under 64. You will do audit under 65. You can do inspection under 67. You can intercept a vehicle under 69, 68 and 129. You can even arrest. You cannot sit in your office and say, I want to check what you are doing. Such a thing is unheard of in GST. It does not exist in GST. Second, how much ever confident an officer is that some hanky-panky is going on, he cannot come to your premises. Please bear in mind, the failure to question such illegal action is on the shoulder of the taxpayer. The taxpayer will be wrong for entertaining. Politely, be polite, be respectful, especially when they are senior officers. All that is fine. If the officer does not listen, what to do? I'll approach this from this point. All this what you're explaining, I understand. It is all theoretical, but officer will come and do whatever he likes to do. What will you do then? Friends, let me tell you this one aspect. Chartered accountants are too much involved in the business of the client. If the client is having financial trouble in the business, the chartered accountant will give suggestion how to approach the banks for loans. If the client is having cash constraints, the chartered accountant will say, my bills you can give after 6 months. See, like this. The chartered accountant is heavily invested in the business and maybe the life of the client itself. Friends, chartered accountants should be like surgeons. Bed number 27, surgery on Monday. Whether the patient in bed number 27 is a sportsman or a sports minister, it does not matter. Whether he's a finance manager or a finance minister, it does not matter. Bed number 27, surgery on Monday. We have to be a little bit objective. Otherwise, we will start analyzing whether the client is capable of paying the tax that is being demanded or not. To look at appeals, many times I have seen appeals are filed for the sake of appeal. Sir, 1 crore liability, sir, I have to file appeal. The longer you delay in final decision, more is the interest you are going to pay. Bank interest is 11%, GST interest is 18% on tax. So therefore, please be very careful. Blindly, we should not encourage appeals. Just like blindly, we should not encourage appeals, we have to also examine whenever any proceeding is being initiated, be very objective. Nothing to worry, only hand is fractured, all the pieces are inside, let them give a notice, then we will reply. We need to make sure that we follow certain steps. How to take which action, which procedure will come first. What department needs to do, we have to understand. In order to be able to appreciate what we need to do, we need to be able to understand what department needs to do. Many instances I have seen where chartered accountants, any provision you give, sir, whether this is taxable, madam, is this, how do you interpret this provision? The answer that we give is trying to say it is not taxable. Somehow I want to give an answer that it is not taxable. Sir, please consider, interpretation is the reason for the interpretation. Pro-assessee or pro-revenue is only a byproduct of that interpretation. We cannot start interpreting the law keeping a goal in mind that I want to make it not taxable. This is called perspective bias. Taxpayer has a perspective bias that anything you say, he says it is not taxable. That is taxpayer's bias. tax department, if you say, see, anything they interpret, the interpretation is to say that it is taxable. So therefore, as chartered accountants, we should maintain this objectivity that interpretation is the reason why we want to interpret. The result can be pro SST or pro revenue, that is because of the law. When we look at GST law, we also have this aspect saying, this law is rubbish. How can you ask this? It is not correct. Remember before the budget, before GST was introduced, how announcement was made, seamless credit, one nation, all of these things, where is all that? I will divide these grievances into two aspects. The reason I'm giving a long explanation is to come to the other perspective. The reason why we give for these grievances is, we have a grievance about the law. We have a grievance about the policy behind the law. If our grievances is about the law, then we can go to court and fight the case. If our grievance is about the policy, we can't go to court. That is the privilege of the parliament. Parliament will decide what it wants to do. Now, when we are interpreting provisions of GST law, we are always thinking from taxpayer point of view. How, what if 2A is less than 3B? 3B is valid, I have an invoice, why I should not pay that? Why I can't take the credit? Why you're paying 12%? No, why 5% also is possible? What is, why is it taxable? No, aggregate turnover should not include agricultural income. Many things we are interpreting. I will submit as objective chartered accountants. I have heard very senior litigators explain this. The amount of preparation that you make for your case, spend more time preparing for the other side. In other words, if we understand how department will look at the business, if we understand how the department will look at the business, then we will be in a better position to give answers. We will be in a better position not only to explain our point of view, but we will also be in a better position to counter the other point of view. In GST, we should be ready for both sides. In GST, if we interpret only from taxpayer point of view, we are completely blind. But let me tell you, there are a number of instances where tax officers will call you, asking you, sir, madam, can you please help me? In this case, there is some issue. How do I issue a show cause notice? That situation also is possible. When will that situation be possible? When you develop this ability to interpret the law from a holistic point of view. Look at it from the other side. When you are prepared from the other side, then you will know exactly how to respond here. The reason why I gave this long explanation is to come back to section 67 and point you in the direction, how is department looking at your business? How is the department looking at your business? When the department is looking at your business, please bear in mind all the aspects, reason to believe, three reasons for taxable person, two reasons for any other person, documenting the reason to believe. Friends, these are all nothing new for the department. To me, it was new when I discovered it, when we were debating it with friends. To department, this is not new. To department, this is a standard manual what they have to follow. Like we have accounting standards, auditing standards, department has standards. If you want to take action under 65, what all should be there before you are given the authorization to proceed? If you want to take action under 67, what all should be there before you take action? But many times the documentation will not be there. But taxpayer fails to question the question. Taxpayer is so enthusiastic to answer why 3B can be more than 2A that the taxpayer does not pay attention to which section they are asking this question. Such a question, why 2A is greater than 3B, cannot be asked under any section. Under 61, it cannot be asked. Under 65, it cannot be asked. Under 67, also, it cannot be asked. Because I will answer what I have done. I will not answer what portal is giving you information. So therefore, please bear in mind, we need to maintain that objectivity. Merits of a case are important. Merits of a case are very important, but the merits of the case cannot come first. Merits of the case will come when it is time for the merits to be advanced. But before merits are answered, first question to ask is, did the department discharge its responsibilities as far as raising this demand? I'll refer to two provisions of Evidence Act very quickly. Section 58. Section 58 of Evidence Act 1872 says, facts that are not disputed do not require to be proved. Facts that are not disputed do not require to be proved. If you don't dispute that there was an intention to evade payment of tax, then it amounts to an admission that there was an intention to evade payment of tax. That is the point. Please bear in mind, department will tomorrow say, you never questioned it, now you cannot question it. Why? 160 subsection 2 says, question it, but at the first time. Later you cannot question it. Next, section 101 of Evidence Act. Person who makes an assertion has the burden to prove that assertion. Person who makes the assertion carries the burden to prove the assertion. In GST law, who is responsible to prove that you are guilty? Who is responsible to prove that the taxpayer is guilty? Revenue. Revenue has to prove. But what will happen in many instances? 2A is less than 3B, so the difference is liable to be reversed. Please show cause why you are not liable to tax, interest and penalty. Now the taxpayer will take that monkey on his back. He will run around trying to show that he is very innocent. No. First, who said 2A is perfect? How many members have received show cause notice under service tax saying 26AS is not matching with ST3? Lakhs of people have received notice saying 26AS income is not matching with ST3 turnover. Who said 26AS is correct? In my 26AS, I came across some TDS deducted. I never know what it is, who the party is. So therefore, I am not answerable for what is in 26AS. In my own 26AS, client has deducted TDS where I have not even done the work before March. My work will start in July, but he's already deducted TDS and deposited TDS. So therefore, if you don't dispute it, it amounts to admission. It does not require any further proof. So therefore, it is tremendously important to identify before answering the merits, what is the question? Are the ingredients of the question satisfied? I'll give a small analogy to drive on this point. Now, there is a cashier who has stolen some money. Cashier in a bank has stolen some money. Is this theft or not? Is this theft or not? If you analyze, anybody will immediately say, of course it is theft. How he can take this cash that was given to him? He's cashier. Cash is given to him to disperse it to all the customers who come to the bank to withdraw. How he can take the cash and run away? It is theft only. No. Common sense says it is theft, but the law requires precise definition. If you look at IPC, theft has a definition. Somebody taking movable property from somebody else's possession. Here what is happening? There is nobody who had the cash. Cashier only was given the cash. So he has taken it away. It is not theft. It is breach of trust. Criminal breach of trust. Friends, like a cooking recipe, even a GST, for every particular section, there is particular ingredient. All food items require salt. Many food items require rice. Many food items require some masala. That does not mean if you throw all the ingredients, it will become the food. It has to have a particular order, particular method, particular sequence. If you change the sequence, it will also become a different product. I don't know if I've been able to successfully convey my concern and anxiety to our members, because our members are the ones who are seeing these instances first. Any query from the department, it will come to Chartered Accountant. Any notice from the department, come to Chartered Accountant. Any phone call from the department also will come to Chartered Accountant. Many times, Chartered Accountant's mobile number and email ID is given as the registered mobile number and email ID for the client's GST registration also. If such is the extent of our involvement, is it possible for us to not be conscious of the requirements under different sections? I'll give you a small, again, identifying the same aspect. Look at the small instance. There is a police constable who stops students. Police constable stops the students who are coming from our branch office, our branch premises after classes. because they're coming on a one way. These boys, you know, after class, they want to go fast. So they are going on a one way. So this constable stops them and says, what are you doing? Why you are coming through one way? These boys who have studied so much of tax and everything, so they are knowledgeable about these things. So immediately they stop the policeman and say, please tell me which section you are stopping me. Please tell me under which section you are stopping me to ask all these questions. Now the police constable is worrying, wondering what to do. He says, okay, all of you go. Next, CET students are coming. I will stop them and collect fine from them. It is important. If you don't ask, if you don't question the question, we will be caught up in the reply to the question, because the other side there is not interested in your reply. 99% nobody is interested in your reply. Your reply is a stepping stone to a demand and a further appeal. Let me share with you this aspect about appeal, since I have mentioned it in 2 minutes. When you look at the aspect of appeal, please bear in mind, friends, the issue that arises is 107, 2 we saw, 108, 1 we saw, looking at how much time, how department can revise this, etc. Let's just look at how many tribunals are there in India today. How many tribunals are there in India today? In central taxes, there are 10 tribunal benches. 10 tribunal benches. State VAT, you know, there is one or two benches, and the pendency there is very limited. In Karnataka, at least 4 or 5 cases are listed every day. In GST, there will be more than 129 tribunal benches. 129 tribunal benches or more are likely to be there. So my expectation is that when preparation is made with so many tribunal benches, it is not that they will not have any work. It is a preparation, because that much work is likely to be there. If that much work is likely to be there in tribunal, now work backwards, how many audits, how many inspections, how many search, how many seizure, how many first appeal, how many revision will all get involved. I estimate that in GST, in the first 20 years, there will be an explosion of litigation, because the law needs to be understood, and revenue is not in a position to give a definitive answer. Definitive answer revenue is not in a position to give. The reason why revenue is not in a position to give a definitive answer is because another answer is possible. For whatever interpretation you take, another answer is possible to say that, no, this interpretation can be taken on this basis also. 18% with input tax credit. After you have paid 18% utilized input tax credit, a position can be taken that 5% without input tax credit should be made applicable. When it is a puja samagri, whether before or after puja, it is always a puja samagri. An interpretation can be taken that this is a general purpose article used for a specific purpose and deny that exemption. Friends, I am not presenting GST to be a complicated law. I am presenting GST as a high stakes legislation. High stakes because the rate of tax is far greater than the rate of profit in a business. And the rate of tax is applied on the turnover of a business. So therefore, any interpretation can be a substantial amount of tax involved. And therefore, it is quite natural that no tax authority will feel free to ignore what is being done. So therefore, they will necessarily take action under different provisions of the law to identify what exactly they need to do. If you look at Section 67 with this background, now you please consider, if a department issues a notice under Section 74, pursuant to an inspection under 67, demanding penalty also under 122, stating that 2A is less than 3B, exemption is not applicable, valuation is not correct, debit note, credit note is not correct, in your own minds, can you identify that theft is different from criminal breach of trust? In criminal breach of trust, the ingredients are different. In theft, the ingredients are different. When the department is free to make any allegation that they feel is better, how can the department choose the wrong section? If the department chooses the wrong section, is the taxpayer required to entertain the wrong section, substance over form, entertain the wrong section, or are there safeguards for the taxpayer? I invite your attention to one section of CRPC, section 222. Section 222 of CRPC says, when a charge sheet is filed, and I'll try to explain in a simple way what the section says. When a crime is committed, but the exact crime is not contained in the charge sheet, then the trial court can convict for that crime even though it is not in the charge sheet. The exact issue that we are discussing is thought about in IPC, where it says CRPC, the procedure code for IPC is in CRPC. In CRPC it says a crime that is committed, that is omitted from the charge sheet, can also be convicted. In GST, do we have a section like that? If the department takes a wrong section and confirms a demand under a right section, if the department takes a allegation and demands tax under a wrong fact pattern, and the adjudicating authority confirms the demand under the right provision and the right fact pattern, it is also okay. Do we have provisions like that? We in fact have exactly the opposite. What is the opposite? Section 75(7). If the show cause notice is given on certain grounds, then adjudicating authority must confirm the demand only on those grounds, but nothing else. The reason why this applies is because of principles of natural justice. Principles of natural justice covers two concepts. Very briefly, I'll touch upon this because it is very relevant for such proceedings. We have to understand that natural justice is at the heart of any judicial proceeding. Principles of natural justice covers two aspects. Nemo iudex in causa sua. No person shall be a judge in his own cause. Audi alteram partem. Hear the other party. Of course, two judgments of the Supreme Court we have to touch upon when we're talking about natural justice. State of Orissa versus Dr. Ms. Veena Pani Day and others. What Supreme Court said here was, principles of natural justice need to be followed even if any legislation does not mention it. Principles of natural justice must be followed even if any legislation does not specifically mention it. Whenever a taxpayer's rights are to be altered, then it cannot be altered without following natural justice. The other decision to touch upon is Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India, where Supreme Court very clearly said, giving a notice with all the relevant information, giving a notice with all the relevant information and the relevant allegations is indispensable. You cannot, however convinced you may be, that nothing the other person can say will change my mind, allows bypassing the due process of law. So therefore, please bear in mind, the law is there to protect revenue, but it does not protect revenue to the prejudice of the taxpayer. Taxpayer has to be given justice. If the taxpayer has to pay tax, he has to pay tax. But the process of recovering tax do not permit the revenue to ignore the taxpayer's rights, trample his rights, and do whatever they like. Now we come back to 67(1). Department in enforcement, anti-evasion, vigilance, when they want to take any action, I feel you are not paying tax correctly. Do you feel that such an approach is even legal? Do you feel that such an approach should even be entertained by the taxpayer? If the taxpayer should not entertain this, can he ignore it and get an ex parte order, or should he respond on merits? If he responds on merits, what happens to his rights? If he does not want to lose his rights and does not want to reply on merits, what kind of a reply should he give? Please bear in mind, GST law contains enormous safeguards for a taxpayer. Search, seizure, inspection, search, seizure, confiscation. These proceedings are not something that are rarely used. In GST, these provisions are widely used. These procedures are widely used, not only in special cases, but it is also used in routine cases. It is a taxpayer who is failing in his responsibility to protect himself. Taxpayer is throwing away his rights, blindly allowing anything to be done by anybody. One important aspect the taxpayer needs to also keep in mind, I got this email also to bring this point for members' consultation. There is this requirement in law that a taxpayer is allowed pre-notice consultations, before giving a show cause notice, consultations should be had with the taxpayer so that if he agrees to discharge the tax, he can discharge the tax and proceed. He need not accept the notice and contest the matter. There are two views about this. I will share both the views. Section 73(5) and Section 74(5) contains a provision where before giving a show cause notice, the taxpayer on own ascertainment or from departmental ascertainment can accept to pay the tax and the interest. Full waiver of penalty is given under 73 and 15% penalty is only charged under 74 so that there is an opportunity to end the dispute and not continue. 73(6) says if the full tax interest is paid, then show cause notice is not required to be issued. So therefore, please keep in mind, whenever a show cause notice is issued, ask yourself whether pre-notice statement is issued. Rule 142(1) capital A specifies the format in DRC(1) capital A, that is the form prescribed to give an opportunity to a taxpayer. When this opportunity is given, it is not for the taxpayer to give 50-page reply. The opportunity for taxpayer is only to say, I accept the liability or I reject this opportunity to discharge the tax demanded. The other view that is being discussed is this pre-notice consultation is in addition to DRC 1A. Pre-notice consultation should be taken up. If pre-notice consultation fails, then DRC 1A can be proceeded before giving show cause notice. My reading of this provision is that DRC 1A itself is the pre-notice consultation. But it doesn't matter which of the two views you subscribe to. The issue that is important to recognize is whenever there is any interpretation taken by revenue, please bear in mind your rights are not lost. It has to follow the due process of law and ultimately be decided in a tribunal or a court what needs to be done. But wherever, I mentioned this earlier also, don't file appeal just because the order is adverse. File an appeal only if the order is perverse. Don't file an appeal just whenever the order is adverse. File an appeal only when the order is perverse. When you look at taxpayers' rights, please bear in mind, we need to make sure what is the scope of any section. Bring my deliberation to a conclusion by submitting this one aspect, where the Privy Council as old as 1936 mentioned this aspect that when a power is given to do a particular thing, that thing must be done in that manner or not at all. Thank Ernakulam branch for giving me this opportunity and all members for your participation in this wonderful refresher course of covering such advanced topics. And if time permits, I will, if there's some questions, I will try and attend them. Now, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Yes, definitely. We have another 15 minutes. So there are a couple of questions in the Q&A box.
I just go through and I will try and answer.
Sure.
Give me 1 second. This box is so small. I'll try and.
Do you want me to read it?
No, I can say, I'll manage. We have received an email from the CGST officer to furnish some information on Tran 1. Can we choose to ignore it as it does not contain DIN number? My humble submission is don't ignore anything. Don't ignore anything. All communication, I shared with you 3-step response. I received a communication dated so-and-so on so-and-so date. I dispute the proceedings initiated and the demand is rejected. Under section 160 subsection 2, I am prohibited from entertaining any proceeding without clarity as to how these proceedings are being initiated. please give a reply so that it does not remain as an undisputed arrear but becomes a disputed arrear and the due process of law takes up. A GST officer went to a retail shop. He wanted to buy something. Since the staff was having lunch, they said, if you want bill, you may have to wait. Then he said, not required. He took the goods of value less than 1,000, paid the amount and left. After a few minutes, he came back to the shop and told them that he is GST officer and you sold goods without invoice and he initiated action. Please advise how the assessee can protect himself from any punitive action by the officer. Please bear in mind, what was the circumstances for selling without invoice? Nobody cares. Whenever you supply, you have to give an invoice. Whether the staff was having lunch and the officer was having urgency, those are not relevant. The approach followed by the officer is not fair, but it is correct. It is correct according to section 6712. So please put up a display sign in the shop saying, do not purchase without an invoice. Something to the effect that everyone is sensitized that you are always going to issue an invoice. Such instances, only preventive steps are possible. Nothing can be done if the officer takes action subsequently. Perhaps only grounds can be taken up based on section 126. There are some safeguards for a taxpayer that I'm sure in a penalty topic you may have a discussion. When a proprietary firm is taken over by partnership firm, what forms need to be submitted for transfer of ITC? And without ITC, whether any ITC need to be reversed by transferring firm as a transaction is exempted from GST. Please bear in mind, transfer of a proprietary firm to a partnership firm, proprietary concern to a partnership firm is a, it must be carried out as a going concern transfer. All assets, all liabilities need to be transferred. When a going concern transfer is made, as per entry number 2 of 12 bar 17, it is exempt from tax. Rule 41 specifies that the transferor needs to upload ITC 02 to transfer the credit to the transferee. Where there is ITC balance, ITC 02 under rule 41 needs to be filed to transfer the credit. Once the credit is transferred, there is no more credit remaining to apply any reversal under section 17.2. So no reversal is to be made, whether there is closing credit or no closing credit. One word of caution, please make sure when we are claiming something to be a going concern transfer, please prepare a closing balance sheet on the date of transfer with all assets, all liabilities. All those assets and all those liabilities must appear in the opening balance sheet of the partnership firm. Otherwise, they may challenge that this is not a going concern transfer. Please look at para 4 of schedule 2. You will find that the incidence of tax will not arise only if it is a going concern transfer. Now, what do you mean by all assets, all liabilities? It is not limited to assets and liabilities on the balance sheet, but there are some assets and liabilities not on the balance sheet. For example, gratuity liability may not be on the balance sheet of the proprietary concern. Brand name, goodwill may not be on the balance sheet of the proprietary concern. So please include everything and then effect a going concern transfer. Whether order of detention is appealable? If yes, whether the department will wait till the time of order of detention is not disposable. Order of detention is a decision. It is not an appealable order because detention will then lead to passing an adjudication order. The adjudication order is appealable. The decision taken by the officer to detain is his own interpretation of the facts and he will detain it. He knows that once he detains it, he now has to pass a provisional release under MOV 5, then issue a show cause notice. So therefore, MOV 9 or MOV 11, those only will lead to appealable orders. A vehicle with goods was intercepted and was found to carry goods without proper tax invoice and challan. With proper invoice and challan, but without e-label. Officer has invoked 130, issued MOV 10 without allowing supplier time to pay the tax and penalty as under 129. What is the recourse? See, 129 is not overriding 130. 129, 130 are two remedies available to the department. Both can be taken. 129 is penalty for not having EVA bill. 130 is for confiscation. For confiscation, please keep in mind, intention to evade payment of tax must be established. In your case, tax invoice is there, delivery challan is there, EVA bill is not there. So intention to evade payment of tax may not be there. So 129 penalty will apply. 130, it appears to be a very weak case. If officer has taken action, it's all right. I told you it is a test match. Allow them to play their innings. You get ready when you get your chance to do batting. If show cause notice is valid and has jurisdiction, then how to proceed? If show cause notice is valid, how to see whether AO has jurisdiction or not? If there is notice for mismatch in 2A versus 3B, how to handle? First of all, who can issue a show cause notice is specified in circular number 31/5/2018. Please look at the circular, you will understand whether that officer is having the jurisdiction if he is a central officer. If it is a state officer, along with the show cause notice itself, he should have given you an assignment note. Normally, there is an assignment given by the Joint Commissioner to proceed under a particular section. Please confirm those. As regards 2A versus 3B, there are about 10 grounds that can be raised. The first ground is to dispute that 2A is an unknown document. Who has filed 2A? Nobody knows. It is a system generated document. If you look at section 155, the taxpayer has the burden to prove that he is eligible to the credit. You can proceed first on technical objections. Next, you can proceed on merits to say, if you have satisfied yourself that you're eligible, then you can put forward all your evidence as to how you say you're eligible to then respond to this notice. But please remember, you are not going to get an answer within 3 months. It will take a few years before this issue is finally resolved. Client needs to be prepared for this. Please touch upon pre-show cause notice. Yes, we discussed this pre-show cause notice issue. In GST, the imposition of penalty is governed by section 122 and 127, and except where the penalty is a fixed sum or calculated percentage, the officer has a discretion. Does the officer have any discretion in charging redemption fine, or is it compulsory? If confiscation is attracted, redemption fine is mandatory. The amount of redemption fine is left in the section as to what is the maximum amount. Therefore, it is completely discretionary based on the facts and circumstance. In customs, the experience that we have seen is that the penalty, the redemption fine, is normally not more than the tax amount itself. It is normally much lower amount. Discretion definitely exists as regards levying redemption fine. But whether redemption fine should be levied or not, there is no discretion. If confiscation is attracted, redemption is a right that the taxpayer has. All right. In case of search, officer coming to client's places and the client interacts with them, the client would have given answers and interpretation and explanation. What is the remedy? Please bear in mind, the verbal discussions are of no evidentiary value unless it is recorded before in a proceedings under section 70. Perhaps it is important to educate clients about their rights. Therefore, they should not unnecessarily volunteer unwanted information. But if something has already been done, you need to examine to what extent that information has contributed as evidence in the show cause notice. If AO sent the notice under wrong section and we replied that you have no jurisdiction, later he correct the notice, then what to do? If the notice has been issued under the wrong section, that notice will be dropped. A new notice under the right section will be issued. That is the procedure. There are many instances under the earlier law where the taxpayer never gave any reply. After 3 years, the department said, why you are not giving reply? At that time, he said that it is under the wrong section. By then, the time limit had crossed. So all these tactics department also is aware. So they will follow up to identify how this response is being given by the taxpayer. So if the section is wrong, then you have to question it. And then the right section, another notice will come. If not, the notice may not come. In section 129.130, speaks about the owner of the goods. The substratum of the GST law has been shifted from sale to supply, as it is evident from the supply between distinct persons. How shall we interpret ownership under this section? Can we resort to sale of goods act? I would like to propose that we interpret this based on a maxim. The maxim says, "Ut res magis valet quam feriat." It means interpret the thing that it survives rather than gets destroyed. When they have used owner and GST has traveled to supply, then the kind of title commensurate with the supply should be substituted. If it is a lease transaction, the lessee will be substituted as the owner here, so as to respond to this notice. I don't think we have to ignore the other forms of supply in GST. What is your applicability of DIN on state GST department? I don't think DIN is of any seriousness. DIN is a, I would think, a internal quality measure of the central government. With DIN also, it is valid. Without DIN also, it is valid. Please don't ignore it. Reply to it, saying that you are not going to reply to it. Don't ignore it just because DIN is not there, because you know, I think circular number 129, which says that whenever a DIN is not there, DIN can be affixed later if there is any emergency situation. So therefore, don't take this DIN so seriously. And state departments may not be, may have not adopted this practice of DIN. Whether order of detention is appealable, we finished this discussion. If yes, whether department, okay, we finished this discussion. Search conducted on the basis of information of fake invoice. At the time of search, team found undisclosed sale in diary and asked to pay tax on 74. Can we contest undisclosed sale issue as bad in law? Of course, you can contest this, because we saw the language in section 174, 147 of income tax, where whatever is escaped according to their knowledge and anything new discovered. Here, there is nothing new discovered here. So therefore, you can definitely contest it. It will take some time in the appeal process, but definitely you have to contest this. In the context of e-mail bill, you suggested not to go for redemption fine, but consider the option to go for SCN, then appeal. No, no, no. Redemption fine itself is decided through show cause notice. It is not that he will call and say, "Do you want to pay redemption fine?" He has to give a show cause notice, first stating confiscation is confirmed. Instead of confiscation, redemption option is given. Do you take it? And that time he will confirm the amount of redemption option. Please don't think it is outside the show cause notice. Nothing can happen outside the due process of law. If the client is not willing to entertain these proceedings due to expenses and time involved, what is the practical way? Please allow the client to decide how he wants to pay the fine. Bed number 27, surgery on Monday. But patient should come to hospital. If patient himself does not want to come to hospital, what can the doctor do? Nothing. Let the client decide what he wants to do. In a going concern transfer, can a division of the entity be transferred? Yes, the language in the entry number 2 of 12 bar 17 says, or a part thereof, as long as it is a divisible segment. Please don't take one segment and artificially divide it into two. If it is a divisible portion of the unestablished business, then you can transfer that also. Received ASMT 14 along with DRC 1, a notice for person hearing, how to proceed and keep track of things. ASMT 14 is issued under section 63, where a person has failed to register and has a liability, or a person had a registration which is got cancelled. Here, notice is issued under ASMT in section 63. Reply to the allegations in the show cause notice and then await an adjudication order whether a demand will be confirmed or it will be dropped. All right. What is the next question? I think those are the only questions. Yes, I think those are the only questions. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. In case we have any more questions, we have another max 2 minutes time to write to us on the Q&A box. Jatin sir, it was absolute pleasure listening to you. 3 hours continuous discourse, and you were going from different laws, legislations, different examples being given. Absolute pleasure listening to you always. Thank you so much for joining Ernakulam branch. You've always been a friend. Last 3 years, every time we have seen you, we've got this kind of awesome response from you. Thank you so much,
sir.
Thank you, participants, for joining us today. Again, tomorrow, we'll be back at 2 p.m. on the same link. Since there are no other questions, sir, we'll call it a day. Thank you so much.